Hey everybody, this is This Week in Science. We are live at the Young Innovators Fair. We are here talking with innovators from all across the greater Philadelphia area. It includes New Jersey, New York, all around the area. And we're talking about science, technology, engineering, creativity, whatever falls under that innovation umbrella. Really.
Arts, performance.
We're getting so
tech,
many.
Everything.
Kevin, who's working with BioBots, just came by and brought a BioBot. It's down next to the stage. He's going to be coming up here in a little bit. Did I enter his interview time? 2:45?
No.
I think that one open slot there. We're going to put Kevin for BioBots.
2:45, we have the Star Wars Geek Girls coming.
Oh, 3:15. There we go. 3:15. 3:15 is going to be Kevin from BioBots. We talked about it a bunch yesterday. We're very interested in finding out how the cellular 3D printer works.
How printer work?
I don't know. But now,
how printer work?
That's right. This Week in Science is a weekly science news podcast. You can find us on twist.org. You can watch live, twist.org/YouTube. All our videos are hosted there as well. You can join our chat online at the twist.org/YouTube as well. We have a live web chat. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/ThisWeekInScience. We're also on Twitter at TwistScience. TwistScience. And I think that's about it for the identification branding kind of stuff. So let's bring our guest up on the stage.
Yes, Sarah Roman, come on up.
Come on.
You're
up.
The next contestant.
No, we're in game show mode. Sorry.
Okay.
Hi, Sarah. So can you introduce yourself and what you're doing here at Young Innovators Fair?
Well, I'm a high school English teacher in Hazlitt, New Jersey, and I'm here today because I've been pairing microcomputers and microcontrollers in my English literature courses in order to better teach my books.
Oh, wait, what?
You use what in your English?
Microcontrollers, microcomputers.
Yeah.
For English.
Yeah. So we're definitely kind of forging on a new frontier.
So explain, what are you doing? How are you doing this?
Well, for instance, and I find it's usually based around summative projects, but we'll take books like Dracula, Beowulf, Frankenstein, all sorts
of classics.
Yeah, the classics.
Right.
And we mutate them into a project that really hits on our STEM and technology skills for some of our students. So I'll use the Raspberry Pi in order to create like a book-based video game for Dracula, for instance.
Wow.
We use the Arduino Uno to recreate the telescreen from 1984.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, we tried out a smart mirror project with the Raspberry Pi in order to have the students basically create a smart mirror for one of their main characters in one of their research books. So what does that character see when they look in their smart mirror in the bathroom
love
in the morning?
That.
Yeah, yeah. So
it's kind of bringing the books to life in a
yeah,
project
right.
sense.
Bringing them into the 21st century.
Yeah, yeah, now that you start to explain it, it actually makes a lot of sense, especially turning Dracula into video game. People have done that already.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, it's a great way to back end some basic coding skills into class, because I use that as a way to introduce grammar, syntax, diction, word efficiency, especially when you're thinking about the structure in like Python, for instance.
And it's a great way to test reading comprehension too, right? Because if you need to design something based on something you've read, you need to be able to pay attention to detail.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
I could look at some of my students' projects for Dracula, for instance, and I could tell right away if they had even read the first chapter, you know, just from visuals alone.
Yeah. You read it, you didn't.
Exactly.
You watched a movie, didn't you?
Yeah.
So did you come into doing this as... did you learn coding? Did you get into the computer stuff? Are you a computer geek yourself?
I am purely a tech hobbyist. So I always tell people I do what I do best. I read. I just read about everything. I consume as much as I can. And I have my ups and downs. I mean, the students love to see me, you know, fail in the classroom. I think it's something that really brings us together when they say,
right,
you have no idea what you're doing right now. I'm like, I don't.
I don't, but
yeah,
I'm trying something.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm going to see if it works.
Yeah.
Do you see your students trying that also, not really knowing what they're doing, and then trying things, failing, starting over?
Yeah, absolutely. They always give it a good shot. you know, they're very kind to me. They always say, okay, we'll try whatever project you have on your mind and we'll see what happens.
So how long have you been doing this? How long ago did it
start? I'd say about 4.5 years. Okay. I've been working through and integrating this. We don't do it every single book and things like that, but when I find a truly relevant project comes up, it's a great opportunity to kind of take it and run with it.
And are you working with a group on this, or is this single-handed?
This is single-handed. I mean, if there are other English teachers out there that are doing this kind of work, I'd love to meet them. It's kind of a lonely place right now, but I'm sure as this starts to pick up, we'll definitely see some more people out there doing it in humanities.
And are you doing something here at the Innovator Fair?
Oh, I am. I'm actually running a teaching literature with the Raspberry Pi booth over there, where I'm talking about anyone who's interested. They can come ask me about my classroom and the things that I'm doing.
Yeah. Are you in the educator's experience? Or
I'm
are you
hiding over in the tech cluster somewhere in the back? Yeah.
I don't see a tech cluster.
I would have to look at the map. Yeah. No,
hiding somewhere around there.
That's great.
There.
You're probably over with the robots.
Yeah, I'm behind Barnes & Noble. Yeah.
So you tech hobby on your own. What got you into that? Like, I mean, reading English, and how do you go from there into becoming a tech hobbyist?
You know, I think I really have to, I owe my mother. She was an administrative assistant, you know, since like 1964. Mm-hmm. So she's always been typing, using computers her entire life. And when I was very little, she got me right into it, having me go to the library when I was like 3 or 4 to take like basic computer classes. And, you know, I've always loved video games, and I guess it kind of stemmed from there.
So, yeah, I mean, from that, do you think getting more girls to play video games then is like, do you think that's like the doorway?
I think it could definitely be one of them. I mean, like, just being able to recreate your experiences in a virtual world, I think, is super important as a way to, you know, solidify identity and really figure out what you want to do on certain platforms and things like that.
Yeah, have you thought at all about going the other direction? So instead of taking classics and porting them out into modern technology, have you thought about taking modern technology to kind of manage a storytelling experience?
I've thought about it, but I'm not sure if my curriculum dictates that just yet. You know,
right.
I tread a thin line with some of this stuff.
I'm sure you've got certain things that need to get done by certain times of the year.
Yeah.
Are you putting any of this information or about what you're doing? Are you out on the web? Are you trying?
You know, I've done a variety of things. Some magazines like the NJAA magazine, Ed Surge. I did a TEDx talk last year.
Cool.
And I have all this stuff on my school website, actually. You know, you can see my basic projects and pictures and things like that. Some of my talks. So, yeah, it's just out there for anyone who's interested.
What's your website?
Oh, it's this is going to be a convoluted, but it's www.abildungsroman.com. So play on the literary device, you know.
Say again, it was
www.abildungsroman.com. I know, yeah.
Blair's like, I don't even know if I can type that.
Yeah. I could spell it out if you wanted.
That would be great.
It would be ABILDUNGSROMAN. Abildungsroman is the technical name for a coming-of-age novel. But I saw that it had S. Roman at the end, so I thought that was clever since I'm Sarah Roman. Yeah.
It fits your name.
It fits it.
But it's good. It connects. So there are all these links. We will... Blair's sharing that right now with our large audience.
Yeah.
So have you gotten, I know TEDx is a local event, but but the videos go up sometimes and are shared by a wider audience. Yeah. Have you gotten much of a response from those?
I have ups and downs. I would say maybe the video's probably gotten, I think, a little over 2,000 hits, but I'm kind of in the vein where if anyone is consuming my work and they're taking from it and getting new ideas, I think it's absolutely great. So slowly but surely is kind of my attitude with this.
Yeah, I mean, to be able to integrate something like this into your classroom, a teacher would have to be versed in microcontrollers, Arduino, the technology that you're trying to get the students to implement.
I think a complicated skill set, especially if you dedicated much of your learning in life to just English literature or the humanities in that case.
Right. But it's I think it's a neat creative path to go down.
Yeah, if you have the time, patience, and the willingness, it's something that definitely adds a new flavor to class.
Definitely different than a diorama.
Yes, absolutely, right? Or in this case, I mean, why not have the diorama move? You know, we're, you know,
yeah,
light it up.
Exactly, light it up. Get some LEDs in there. Get some EL wire.
Yeah,
get some
yeah, absolutely.
I love it. There could be so many creative things to bring out of those classic novels.
That, yeah,
and it just brings
absolutely.
It to life.
Yeah, you know, I know we sometimes do those 5-paragraph essays, but other times it's just so great to get them working with their hands.
Yeah. Do you find that they get a little bit more excited about the stories when they start doing these projects as opposed to like, oh, compare and contrast and.
I think it depends on the project. If they can kind of see the light at the end of the tunnel, if they really understand why I'm purposefully trying to do this, they do become very invested. I think sometimes, and like I said, it's really kind of paying mind to them because sometimes I am comfortable with things that they're not. So I can kind of see where the pitfalls are in certain things. So it's always just experimenting and kind of seeing what works.
That's so neat.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for sharing
of course.
With us.
Yeah,
I think it's very... A new approach to teaching English, and that's great.
Just trying.
And I hope other people will check out your TEDx talk, and
yeah, that would be great.
And your website, yeah.
All right,
thank you so much. Yeah, it was great to meet you.
By.
Thank you. I hope lots of people will come by your booth.
Oh, I hope so, yeah.
See you later. You know, it is... almost 2:30 in the afternoon. I've been bouncing around here and I'm starting to fade. But you know what? I'm going to keep my energy level up because that's what I do. We're going to keep talking about science for the next 2.5 hours.
Woo! I need more goldfish.
You need more what?
Goldfish?
More goldfish. I can throw them at you.
If anybody wants to watch Blair eat a goldfish live,
not a real goldfish.
No, but she'll be doing it live on the air.
She'll be doing it live on the air.
That is
true. It'll be a cracker goldfish.
On goldfish crackers. This is This Week in Science. I'm Dr. Kiki. And there's also...
Justin.
And...
I'm Blair.
And we have a weekly science news podcast. We air live online every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Pacific time, 11 p.m. Eastern. But we are also... It's a podcast. So you can subscribe to us on iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker. Find us on YouTube and Facebook. And you can listen to our shows, you can watch our shows, because we are initially a live video broadcast. Mm-hmm. And we have a lot of fun talking about all the science news that comes out every week, at least the stories that we curate, mm-hmm. you know, according to our interests and what we enjoy. And thank you so much. Thanks for joining us. I hope you're enjoying the fair. Good.
Excellent.
Awesome. You got a big smile on your face. That's good.
Been seeing lots of big smiles today. This is definitely a fun event.
So what I'm hoping, so I went on a walkabout, and do you guys know Bose speakers?
Yes.
I went around, and there's a booth for Bose, but it's not their normal speakers. Bose now has a
product.
Does
Bose make normal speakers?
They don't really make normal speakers anyway, but they're very scientifically oriented. They're really good speakers, small speakers that put out a lot of good can be very loud for their size, but also put out very high quality sound. So a lot of scientific principles behind how they function. Now, they have a product for kids that it's a speaker kit that's completely, you can take the whole thing apart, see how the wires fit together, look at the magnet in the speaker. There's a screen that you can actually look at the sound waveform and play with amplitude and frequency and see how the activity of the magnet changes.
Cool.
There are LEDs in the side of the speaker. They're these kind of opaque plastic shells that walls that can come off the cube. It's a speaker. The speaker's a cube. These little plastic walls come off. You can change the color of the LEDs and customize it to make it whatever color you want. You can also use 3D printing, and there are plans for dimensions online that you can download it, and you can 3D print your own designs to fit into the sides of the speaker. So you basically design your own speaker.
Wow.
That you build yourself. You build the speaker from from the parts that are provided in this kit, you can learn about how the speaker works, and then it's your speaker.
So I can make a speaker shaped like a turtle?
Well, it's a cube.
Well, you could make the edges different shapes.
You could put the shapes in there. Come on up! All right, we have another guest now.
Justin, there's four chairs.
For This Week in Science. Justin.
Are you going to sit down, Justin?
There we go. All right, so this is This Week in Science, and we are currently, we're going to have another guest here. We're going to have a little conversation about water filtration.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so can you tell us your name and who you're here with? What are you doing here?
Yeah, sure. My name is Dylan Lunny. I'm the Director of Communications for All Horizons. We're a nonprofit organization based in Brooklyn, New York. We partner with organizations all around the world and do biosand filters. So it's a point-of-use household water filtration unit. Super simple, super inexpensive. It uses cement, out-of-body, sand, and two sizes of gravel, and filters people's water. It takes 98% of the bacteria out of their water.
Wow.
We're partnered with organizations all over the world that actually run the projects themselves using our technical resources.
And so, I mean, I've talked about the technology of water filtration, and we've got all these fancy membranes for filtering water and taking out tiny particles. You're using sand and gravel.
Yep.
How does that work?
Yeah, our whole organization's motto is low tech, high thinking. So basically, biosand filters utilize the microbes that are already in a water source. So, for instance, our main project is in southwestern Bangladesh. People are getting their water and from like a surface water, so like a pond, bringing it home and pouring it into their filter. And these microorganisms that are living in the water, they actually start to make a home inside the filter. And they prey on the new microorganisms that get poured in, and it filters the water. So it's kind of harnessing the power of nature in a little box that goes in someone's home.
How'd they come up with this idea? Like, where did this come from?
It was invented by a scientist that started the Center for Affordable Water and Sanitation Technology, Dr. Manns out of Canada. It was invented in the 1990s. And we found these filters, thought they were amazing, but our organization wanted to make them even more accessible because the way they were originally invented with was a steel mold, which was prohibitive because you needed a skilled welder and they cost a lot of money. So we engineered a wood mold that's much more DIY accessible and lowers the cost about ninefold.
Well, so you have a wood mold. And then this can ship anywhere, and then once that's in place, somebody can make a concrete version of this. Is that right?
So
what is it?
Basically, we have a construction manual and an appendix of how to run this project on our website. It's open source, so anyone anywhere can download it, follow the step-by-step construction manual, and build the mold themselves. And then you pour the concrete into the mold, and each mold makes 50 concrete filters in its lifetime. So we don't actually sell it or ship it. We empower other people to build it themselves.
You basically empower them to get the instructions and then build it themselves and be able to provide clean water for how many people?
So right now, 7,000 people are using our water filters daily.
Wow, that's awesome.
By the end of the year, that number is going to be about 22,000. And those are just, we're going to double it, triple it every single year, where you see we're going to have a hockey stick effect as we can actually prove the health impacts and get larger organizations to actually buy in and start doing it as well. I think we have to show actual data and impact reports, and as well as just educate people about this, because people don't really know that much about biosand filters right now.
Yeah, so my husband uses a Brita water filter, and those charcoal filters last about 3 months, 90 days or so. How long does the sand last? Is this something that has to be recharged? It has to be refilled periodically?
Yep. So no, it doesn't. It doesn't become saturated the way the charcoal works, where it's filling the pores and they become unusable. This is the natural biological process, so it's constantly working and cleaning itself. There's no electricity involved. It can be used off-grid and lasts, we say, plus 15 years.
So these can last over 15 years?
Yes.
Yeah. You make it, and then you've got it cleaning your water for 15 years?
Yes.
Wow.
Is there a time? How long does it take for it to do its purification process? You pour this dirty water in, and how long till you're pouring out clean water you can drink?
Yep. So we recommend that you let the water sit in there for 4 hours. So we call it a 4-hour pause period. Basically, it does 11 liters every 4 hours. You're always going to have water that's sitting in the filter, and when you pour new water in, gravity pushes the water that's been sitting in there and filtering up and out the spout. And then we always have next to our biosand filters a safe water storage container that's going to be about a 5-gallon water container. So whenever someone wants to access their water, they can just go to that container and open up the spout and they have water. But so it's not like they're not able to use it or they have to wait. It's readily available and it can do...
It's an ongoing basis, 5 gallons at a time.
Yep, so it does about 12 gallons of water a day.
That's significant. That's a significant amount of water for just one of these units. Can it be scaled up?
So that's what makes our organization and our engineering project with the wood mold super exciting, is that the cost of the steel mold of doing these biosand filter projects was really prohibitive, because you could only have grassroots organizations on the ground could only have one or two steel molds. Whereas for the same price, you can have about 9 of our wood molds and take that and have, I guess, if you had 2 steel molds versus 18 wood molds, you pour concrete into the mold and let it sit overnight and then it gets demolded. If you multiply those numbers out in a single month, you can have, either 9 times 30 or you can have 1 times 30. So it's a game changer in the way that it can scale.
This is amazing. So you're focusing globally, but what areas? I mean, most of the United States, we've got nice water sanitation systems in most cities.
Yeah.
Are there areas of the United States that this will even be helpful in, or are you focusing on third world countries?
Yeah, we're focused on developing nations. Our prime project right now is in southwestern coastal Bangladesh.
That's an area that has some serious problems with water availability and cleanliness. Lots of cholera outbreaks there.
Yes. And then we have a global vision. So we've run projects in Ecuador, Kenya, Mali. So it really applies anywhere where people have a surface water source, where they're dealing with the biological contamination, because it focuses primarily on bacteria contamination.
Right. So this is mostly bacteria. Does it affect anything like heavy metals, or do metals still come through?
Metals will still come through. So we need to be conscious of testing the water beforehand and making sure that our particular technology fits what the needs are of that community.
Right. So I know in Bangladesh, there's also issues with arsenic contamination. So it's kind of weighing. What's more important, the cholera or the arsenic?
And arsenic might not be such a bad thing. It actually primes the immune system pretty well to combat if anything else.
Until you reach certain levels.
Right. We're very careful to make sure that we're going to regions that aren't going to have arsenic, and especially that's going to be in the groundwater. And that's what leads to people using surface water. Like ponds, because of the issue with arsenic.
So they have arsenic contamination in the wells, and then they can't drink that, and the communities move to the surface water, where they're going to ponds that are maybe, they've got lots of growth in them.
Exactly, lots of bacterial growth. But these filters are extremely effective and inexpensive at removing that, so it's a great option.
So is this the only is this the only thing that O Horizons is currently working on, or are there more projects kind of on the way?
On the way, but not in the near future.
not at liberty to discuss.
Well, it's a long story. Our organization, we think of the four horizons of life as water, agriculture, energy, and economic development. Uh-huh. And we want to develop a low-tech, high-thinking innovation that can be locally implemented by organizations for all four of those. But right now, we're focused on getting this water technology to take off, and then we'll probably move into energy, but I don't see that happening in the next couple of years. We really want to focus on getting this.
Yeah, that's a pretty big undertaking. It's pretty exciting, actually. Yeah.
But I think your company has chosen the right direction to go in, because water availability is really one of the impending disasters on the planet at the moment.
It's absolutely fundamental to everything else right above it. And so, the organization got started thinking about people and hunger issues. And kind of from there, what stems and what creates these hunger issues. And that's how the four horizons of life got discovered. And water was the number one issue that we had to figure out right away.
Are you working, you've got this program trying to get water to people. Are you trying to educate people on water availability at all? Or just get this filtration device out there?
Yeah, so another key component of what we do is, especially young people in the United States, since this is a global issue, kind of educating them about the water crisis.
Yeah.
People don't really realize that about 1 out of 10 people in this world don't have safe drinking water access. Yeah. And so kind of helping connect the dots with kids, and especially our technology and our approach really fits within the maker movement.
It does.
Because we have the construction manual, we have this whole science and technology and engineering aspect to it. So we've tied it in with that, and just letting kids know, like, you know, if there's, I just gave a speech here at this Young Innovators Fair, and my whole speech was using design for social good. And just, you know, if there's a problem, there's some solution that you can design to fix that, and kind of empowering people to think creatively in order to make change.
We had a few young girls here from an after-school girls coding program, and they're learning how to code, and they were very excited about using coding to change the world. And I mean, one of them only wanted to code a robot to bring her Oreos, but the other ones wanted to do things to change the world.
That's where you start, and that same robot can then like be exploring Mars. I mean, it starts with bringing you an Oreo cookie, but
bring me an Oreo cookie from Mars.
Yeah, this Young Innovators Fair. I've listened to Gabe talk about how he set it up, and you know how you can find out what your kids are into, and kind of curtail their interests and help them figure out what they want to do. I think it's amazing. Just stimulating them and letting them kind of create and learn what they like.
Yeah, I think one of the big things is just allowing people to know that there are questions, there are things that need to, problems that need to be solved, and you just need to put your mind to it. And if you are, you might be the person who can help with that.
And so, and then it brings up a question, like, how do you help with this? So you've got this innovative adaptation of this invention. You've made it so it can be cost effective and easy to use. You've tested its effectiveness. You know it's going to work. But you still have to go out into the field. And I mean, anybody can go to the website, but they're going to have technology there that allows them to do that. And probably if you have a computer and high-speed internet, probably already have access to cleaner water, I would assume. Could be wrong.
It's surprising.
What is it?
More people have a cell phone these days than a toilet in the world.
Oh wow, that's wild.
It's really interesting the way things work like that. And I think we can actually tap in and find these implementation partners in these developing places in the world that will actually be able to do the project. Right now,
so they find you and then take it out into their local field.
Yes, so we don't implement anything. We partner with other organizations who employ local people.
Gotcha.
They do the purchasing of local materials, and the project becomes its own economic development project as well in the area.
Nice.
Multiple levels of helping people out. I love it.
Yeah, teaching people how to fish instead of providing fish for them.
It's always the better procedure, the better thing to do. Yeah.
It makes it sustainable too. Just so if you know, lots of what we see in the world of water sanitation and hygiene is you know a foreign NGO provides something for a local community and one piece breaks, but then that one little piece isn't locally available. So then the whole system stops functioning and people lose their clean water access. So this is really about empowering other people. So that's not going to happen.
That's not going to happen. They'll be able to keep running. A piece of wood breaks, you just replace a piece of wood.
Exactly.
You run out of sand, you go find some more sand.
Yep.
Yeah. And then you don't have somebody going, "Where's my fish?"
Right? Yes.
Give me my fish.
Exactly.
No, go get your own fish. I taught you how to get a fish. Go get a fish. Yep. Thank you so much for joining us. Yeah, I really appreciate it.
Awesome.
Really, I heard about it yesterday and walked by and saw you have a demo unit out here at the Young Innovators Fair. Are a lot of people coming by to take a look?
Yeah, lots of. I mean, people are so fascinated and so inquisitive, and there's so much to say. It's hard to like kind of break it down and make it really, really simple quickly, but people are really fascinated with it.
I think that's wonderful. Well, I'll let you get back to your booth because I know you're the only person there. You need to go educate people.
Yep. thank you so much for having me and letting me talk
about it. Okay. Thanks so much, Dylan.
All right, thank you.
Take care. Maybe we'll run into you at PJ's again.
Yeah. Sounds good.
More freckles. Last night, Blair and I went out to dinner, and Dylan was across the bar from us. We didn't know who he was last night, but now we know, and he knows that I like freckles.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll keep those. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Have a good afternoon. All right, guess who's next?
This is This Week in Science. We like science, but we also like other fun things.
Yeah.
We like Star Wars. We like cosplay. We like all sorts of cool things.
Star Wars Geek Girl Podcast coming up next on This Week in Science.
Hello. Come on up here. We're hanging out.
Hi.
Yeah. Can you introduce yourself to us?
I'm Zoe Hinton, and I cosplay Sabine, and I do Star Wars Geek Girl Podcast.
Why did you start the Star Wars Geek Girl Podcast?
I thought it'd be fun. My dad kind of influenced me. He's like, "Oh yeah, you should do it. You like talking and you like Star Wars. Do a Star Wars podcast." It's okay. And I started it. Yeah.
Do people seem to enjoy? Is it you on your own?
It's me and then my co-host, Lizzie, who lives in California. So we do it over Skype.
It's kind of the way we do our podcasts. Blair lives in San Francisco. Justin lives in Davis, California. I live in Portland, Oregon. We all get together virtually using Google Hangouts.
Yeah, how did you meet your co-host?
She was actually a guest on episode like 5 or 6, and then we just kind of hit it off really well, and I was like, "Hey, I don't have a co-host. You want to, you know, do it with me?" So we just, no.
Oh, is that how
that's kind of how Kristen got me involved.
Yeah. You find your co-hosts. Everyone finds their co-hosts in different ways. So what are some of the things like, So it's Star Wars. What are some of the things that you geek out about when it comes to your podcast?
We talk a lot about like news and the Rebels, Star Wars animated series, when that runs, like when the season's going. We talk about that in every episode. We podcast every week, so we have new episodes to talk about news, comics, books, new movies, everything.
Okay, so the new stuff that's coming out is you're not like rehashing the old movies.
No,
and you know, Han shouldn't have shot first.
That's been settled. There's a lot of settled issues in Star Wars. Han shot first is one of them. Kiki, don't start with that again.
I know. What do you think of midichlorians?
I didn't have much of a problem with them. They weren't like very prominent, so I didn't really.
All right.
Are you excited for Star Wars Land?
I'm very excited for Star Wars.
Are you going to go to Florida or Anaheim?
Wait. What Star Wars Land? Tell me about Star Wars Land.
I don't know about Disneyland.
Oh, in Disneyland, yeah. There's going to be a Star. It's going to be like Cars Land.
Kind of, yeah. It's like, you know, like Harry Potter World and Universal. Yes. It'll be like that, but Star Wars. I'm very excited for that in Disney Park. So we're going to Orlando.
You're going to go to Orlando. Yeah, that makes sense. I'm pretty excited because I've heard that it's not actually any place that you've previously been in Star Wars and anything Star Wars before. It's a new world. So it's supposed to be in the universe verse in the story, but it's not. It's not a place you've seen portrayed in movies or on TV. So it's pretty exciting.
That's what I heard.
Well, it'll be exciting for everyone to go visit.
And the Star Wars world is bigger than just the movies. I mean, there was a whole Clone Wars cartoon series that you and I missed. Yeah. But then there's also online gaming.
Yeah, there's games, comics, and books that are canon now, and then Rebels, which is a sequel animated series of Clone Wars.
Okay, so for a lot of us who are thinking of Star Wars as a movie, we're missing a very large portion of the content of the Star Wars world already. I've been very excited since Disney took over Star Wars.
Yeah, same.
Because it does mean you don't have to wait every 2 years and then a decade between new content.
We're gonna. Isn't there
and
a new movie?
Doing
there's
an amazing
a new movie.
Job already.
New movie
Christmas,
coming out
right?
next winter.
Christmas.
We're gonna see Luke again.
Yeah.
Find out what he's been up to on the island. Being a hermit.
What is Luke doing in Ireland?
Why is he on the... Well, you know, he...
Well, he went on a 4-hour tour. And then...
No.
It was a 3-hour tour.
This one was longer.
He feels responsible for Kylo Ren going to the dark side. And he's like, what'd I do wrong? I have to give up being a Force dude and live on an island by myself.
Yeah, and he has all the porgs, which are like little puffins, apparently. They're little birds that live on the island with him, and they're like his friends, little bird friends.
The little birds on the island?
I mean,
he's talking to the birds now for company.
My friends are the little birds on the island.
Luke, you've been on the island too long.
If you're talking to the birds, this is a problem.
Yeah.
we'll just take care of you for a little while. Why don't you... like this nice little room with the pads on the walls.
Oh my gosh. So this movie is called The Last Jedi. Do you think it's really The Last Jedi?
I think so.
I think it's a ruse.
But who's The Last Jedi? Is it going to be Luke's The Last Jedi? Or is it going to be, what's her name?
Rey.
Rey is The Last Jedi. Is she, it's like...
I mean, in other languages, it's translated to plural.
Oh,
like it's translated
Spanish,
to what?
It's plural. Like in Spanish, it's
the last
Jedi, which is plural.
Yeah, it's not. Jedi is also plural of Jedi. It's the singular and the plural.
Oh, this puts a whole new spin on it. I'm so glad we're talking.
It's not
with
Return
you.
Of the Jedi's.
So you put out your podcast every week.
Yeah.
When does it come out, and where
Jedi's
can people find it?
You can find it on SoundCloud and iTunes.
Okay.
You can find us on Facebook and Twitter as well. Twitter, it's SW Geek Girl. Facebook, it's Star Wars Geek Girl. And, iTunes, SoundCloud.
And is it, do you have a certain day of the week that you release?
We record on Thursday, so we usually release it around on Friday or Saturday.
Nice. And so tell me a little bit about your cosplay. This is fun.
So I'm Sabine Wren, which is Star Wars Rebels, which is the current animated series on Disney XD, and she is a Mandalorian and an artist and a rebel. So, the bright colors and everything.
Yeah.
And so she fights with the Rebellion, helps found it, and that's Sabine.
So do you come up with lots of different ideas for your cosplay, or is this like your main character? Or
yeah, we do Sabine. She has every single season, she changes all of her armor.
Ooh.
So you have season one, season two, this is season two, and season three is, you know, being worked on.
So you're currently working on season three right now.
Yeah, my dad's...
Your dad's helping. What goes into making your outfits? What is this made of?
This is a 3mm PVC plastic, and you heat it with a heat gun, and I wore like sweatpants and sweatshirt. My dad like molded it to bend how we needed it to bend. The one gauntlet here, this piece is plastic 3D printed, and then this is foam with a little screen in it.
Nice, and then you paint it all. And the helmet.
We bought the helmet, and then this we got sewed by someone around us. And we don't like use leather and stuff, so our the belt is made of like a pleather,
mm-hmm.
and then the pistols are wood.
And I see some duct tape.
Yes, duct tape.
Because duct tape is the best. Oh, fun! So you're incorporating a lot more 3D printing for the new season's outfit.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, here's a quick question.
It's good to have a 3D printing.
Can you make more duct tape with a 3D printer?
Normally I'm dressed as a stormtrooper. So, because actually Zoe, besides her podcast, has been doing charity work with the 501st since she was five.
Five.
I guess she started out as a Jawa. So we do charity work. You know, we're raising money.
Who are we raising money for right now? Make a Wish.
Yeah, so we're doing Make a Wish, but we do, you know, any charity work. Usually more weekends than not, we're doing charity work. And to toot her own horn, she did do a panel at Star Wars Celebration with her co-host. So, and she's had a couple articles published. So I'm very proud that of her love of Star
That's
Wars.
That's so awesome. And I love the combination of doing charity work and following a passion at the same time. That's a great place to be, and that's an exciting thing to be involved with.
So, are you going to Dragon Con?
No, we're not.
Oh, that would be a fun. You went to. Okay, so you do go to cons, and you went to Celebration and Pittsburgh Steel City. Any others?
We small local cons we'll go to sometimes if we have a free weekend.
Nice. I love it. Star Wars for charity. Thank you so much for talking about your podcast with us and your outfit. I love it's, I mean, it's beautiful. You've got some great artwork. The painting is really well done.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So yeah, I've got a 10-year-old daughter at home. I'm going to turn her on to the Star Wars Geek Girl podcast because I think she's really going to like it.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah. So if you look for a Star Wars Geek Girl podcast online, iTunes, SoundCloud, you'll be able to find it. She's also on Facebook and Twitter. Everybody out there, if you're interested in Star Wars and you want it from a geek girl perspective, yes. And dad's a proud dad. Nice. Oh, that's a great outfit too. Oh my goodness. I love that. It's a Ketsu. Nobody else has been Ketsu yet. Nice work. It's beautifully done. Wonderful. Oh my goodness. I love it. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Have a great afternoon. This is the Young Innovators Fair. We are This Week in Science. We're having such a great time talking with everybody. I love cosplay for the creativity of the costumes that people come up with. I mean, I've gone to Burning Man, and people come up with costumes that they create out at Burning Man, but there's something about taking these fictional characters out of books, movies, anime, and turning them into, putting yourself inside of them and being that character for a day or longer, but putting those costumes together, I think, is so neat. And the materials now, like she was saying, taking this PVC plastic and like bending it and turning it into the pieces you need for the costume. Other people use like foam core and mold pieces of foam, large pieces of foam, into big shoulder pads.
Yeah,
and
I did a little bit of cosplay when I was a little kid.
When you were a kid?
When I was a kid. Although mine was not that involved. I was Indiana Jones. So I basically just needed a fedora and a bullwhip, and I was there. I had some brown corduroy pants, too, I think, that I was.
Yeah, we have a friend's son who, every time I see him, he's wearing a different outfit. I'm like, who are you today? And he's like, he'll tell me who he is, and he's from a video game, he's from a movie, he's from a cartoon he likes, sometimes from a book he's read. But like almost every single day, he's got like paint on his face and a different outfit on, and I'm like, what is going on here? As he gets older, I am convinced he's gonna be in cosplay for sure. He's gonna be making his own costumes, developing ideas.
Yeah.
It's going to be good. It's going to be good. I hope kids out there and kids of all ages are getting inspired at the Innovators Fair today. There's so much going on here, and we've had some great conversations today with people from all over the greater Philadelphia, New Jersey, New York area. Some wonderful conversations. Just a few moments ago, spoke with Dylan from O Horizons. His booth is over on the other side of the room, and his company has developed he's the communications manager, but the company where he's worked for, O'Horizons, has developed a low-cost water filtration system using wood and sand. It's amazing. And concrete. I think concrete's probably the hardest thing to come by for that project.
And it uses the bacteria already in the water as the filtration system as well. It's amazing.
Oh. Blair's brain is mush. She's not remembering anything. I keep trying to send out a social media message, and I've gotten about halfway into it several times. And okay, you guys say some things so I can type on the computer.
Here's some things.
Yeah, say some sciencey things, you people. Justin?
Yeah. So what is your favorite thing that you've seen today? Did I already ask you that question?
My favorite thing, I actually love the dry ice. I love dry ice.
That was cool. Those bubbles were really wild.
The more ways I can figure out how to use dry ice, the better.
I gotta figure out if the mad scientists are in my neck of the woods.
I think they're everywhere. I'm pretty sure.
Dry ice is actually
really great for demonstrations and experimentation in relation to ocean acidification because it's carbon dioxide. So it's a really easy way to add carbon dioxide to water and see what happens with the pH scale, with the acidity. So just plop in some dry ice. It's pretty cool. And, you know, kids also just love dry ice. They love anything that smokes.
It smokes. You just put it on the table and it's got this smoke coming off of it, yet it's not a fire.
Yeah.
What's going on there? Oh, sublimation. Teaching moment. Ta-da! We're going to be joined.
And it looks like we're being
minute.
Joined mm-hmm. by NeuroTinker.
Yeah. Yeah, you can come on up on the stage whenever you're ready.
We put a blue stripe on it, but people keep tripping over it. Exactly. Just like that. Just like that.
Closer than you might think. Your microphone just
stopped working. Where's my lapel mic? Oh,
okay. All right. Would you like to introduce yourself and talk a little bit about what you're doing here at the fair?
Sure. My name is Joe Berto. I'm a neuroscience educator. So I've taught for 9 years at the college level at Boston College, neuroscience and physiology. A couple of years ago, I started up a company with an engineer co-founder, Zach Ferdin. He's based out of Minneapolis. The company's called NeuroTinker. We're all about getting kids to learn about the brain while they're physically building their own neural circuits. So it's kind of combining engineering and biology and neuroscience, physiology together in a hands-on manipulative way. Excuse me, we call it Lego for the brain. So it's a hands-on tool. We know that adults, kids, we learn best when we're doing something in a hands-on way, not just textbooks, not just lectures. We need to be engaged in that manipulative learning. It works really well. So our neuron simulators allow kids to do that. They can build reflexes. They can build circuits that will model the ear, the eye, build robots and buggies controlled by neurons and brain circuits.
So how do the components work? Can you walk us through like how you would put them together to, say, model a reflex?
Sure, absolutely. So Zach, my engineer, he's the one that actually built the circuitry and coded the neurons with the neuron behavior. The way they work, once you've got an individual neuron or multiple ones, they're modular units, just like an individual Lego. They connect together with what we call neurotransmitter cables. So the wires that connect them together are actually modeling the chemicals in your own brain that allow your own neurons to talk to each other.
Okay, so the wires are like the synapse.
Yep, so the synapse, when you say synapse, usually that means like the space
between.
Yeah, exactly. So the wires are like the chemicals that are released from that presynaptic cell to the postsynaptic one. Because you can't, obviously you're using electrical components, you can't just dump chemicals or liquid on there.
I mean,
we have to model the chemicals with the wires.
Yeah, so neuronal function, the way they normally work is you have the electrical transmission down the neuron and then the release of the chemicals to then stimulate new ion transmission and the electrical conduction down the next neuron.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So we're modeling that with our simulators so that cables send that signal to the next neuron, processes it. It's all about those individual neurons and whether or not they get excited enough to fire what we call an action potential.
Yep. Right?
That's a term where they hit some level of electricity, They get excited enough, they pass that signal on to the next one, just like you said. So as kids, adults, anybody, makers, build the network out, the behavior actually emerges out of that pattern of connections that you've built with those cables.
Okay, so say for the reflex, you know, we've got the typical reflex when you're at the doctor, you've got a model over at your table of the, you know, the knee tap reflex where you hit the tendon and that also stretches the nerve and it signals that that creates a mechanical stimulus that but also stretches ion channels, opens them up, allows the flow of ions and electricity. Neuron gets going and it triggers muscle contraction.
You should teach my class. You should come in. You should actually just give up what you're doing now. Come and teach my class instead, because that's a great description right there.
And so your modeling is, so in the model and the way that the components work, do you have to tap at different strengths to actually trigger that modeled reflex?
Let me write that down, because that's probably something you want to add in for next time. So no, the way that it works right now is that one tap on the knee, on the patellar tendon, that's enough to set the circuit in motion.
Okay.
So it's all about how much depth you want to get into when you're modeling it, right? We're, our target market is middle school and high school right now. So we're kind of glossing over the ion channel part that you just talked about.
Yeah.
But when we're talking about simulations for the college level, grad school level, we'd love to be able to talk about things like that.
Right.
So we might be that if you hit it hard enough, maybe you're pretending to open more ion channels that'll set, you know, more excitation in motion. Right now, one tap activates, fires an action potential in the sensory neuron. That goes to the inner neuron, the two motor neurons, the four neurons that are in all of our spinal cords that actually produce that reflex.
Right.
We model that with our neurobites patellar tendon reflex.
So this is this something that would be used supplementally in classrooms as teachers are working through this? Say, okay, you're looking at the textbook that has this reflex model in it, and you look in the textbook and you go, oh, there are these four neurons, blah, 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 blah. So what?
Yep.
And then suddenly the kids are able to go hands-on, let's put them and see why there are four neurons.
Yep.
Is that
it
the,
is.
The goal?
Yeah, so you think about a textbook or even a lecture, you have these static pictures that are being shown, but it's hard to really engage with what that means and how it's changing over time. As the educator, the neuroscientist on our team, I'm developing the experiments and the curricula that will go into the classroom or go to the parents and the homeschooling groups to allow them to engage with that for the first time. Usually it is a picture, like we're doing video scribe videos that show for 30 seconds or a minute, like this is how you initially engage with it. Here's a pause point, go in, dive in, build the circuit. But a lot of times it is from that initial picture, like, oh, this is kind of how it flows. Let's stop. Let's start to build that. And then you get the motion that emerges out of that static picture.
So the reflex is the reflex. That's a very simple neuronal circuit.
Yeah.
How complex can it get with your kit?
How much money do you have? Do you want to buy 100 billion of them right now to like model a brain?
Right, model a brain. There
you
we
got
go.
Your checkbook with you. I've put the manufacturing into motion right now. So we've put about 50 together. You can typically power right around there with one individual battery pack.
Okay.
All of the products we have right now are our prototypes from a year or so ago. Literally this week, we've got new neurons that are being made for our first sort of production run. We've got workshops coming up this summer, so educators and students will be able to get hands-on experience with new neurons that are specific to not just the general neurons we have, but that do, they're kind of catch-all neurons. The new ones are photoreceptors. They're
cool. So you can model the retina.
Yep. So they're specialists. Like our neurons really are in our own eyes and ears.
Do you have like inhibitory neurons?
We do. So we have the interneurons are going to be dedicated units. And then we also have sensory neurons. We also have motor neurons that are dedicated units.
Wow.
We've got a cochlea that we're building.
Oh, cool.
So you can understand like tonotopy about how different frequencies will excite the cochlea at different points.
Right.
So we're getting into biomedical markets that way and getting kids to understand how cochlear implants work. So there's something like 1 million people around the United States that have a cochlear implant, which really is, I mean, they're essentially becoming almost robots at that point. There's a brain, it's a brain interface. You talk about a cochlear implant and how it's taking that.
Not robots, more bionic.
Yeah, I should say bionics, not robots, exactly.
And so cyborg.
Those are much better terms. Of taking that environmental information and bypassing the part of the nervous system that isn't working properly.
Yeah.
Getting inputs into the cochlea, and then you can hear, amazingly, what's going on in your environment. We're modeling that with some of our new prototypes, too.
That's cool. So right now it's all prototype. And yep. How soon? When is this going to be available to people who might want to use it?
Sure. So this, actually, like I said, this week and next week, the prototypes are literally being made in a factory in Minnesota. Nice. We manufacture in the United States. This next month, we've got our workshops where we'll be getting more information from our teachers and our students to help us with the final touches on the hardware and the experiments. This coming fall, we're probably going to have a Kickstarter effort.
Okay.
So if people want to follow along with what we're doing, neurotinker.com is our web address. We've got an email list. We'll be giving you more information about that Kickstarter effort or our manufacturing this fall, so you can get kits for your students, for your children at home, homeschooling groups, to understand how you can engage them in that hands-on learning when it comes to neuroscience and the brain.
That's wonderful. I mean, neuroscience is one of the more advanced scientific subjects mm-hmm. to address, but this is going to make it so much more approachable and engaging for
students.
That's
my hope.
Yeah.
I've got a 10-year-old daughter and a 5-year-old daughter now, and my goal was to make it easily understandable enough for them, even at that level, to get something out of it, to understand a little bit about what the brain's all about, but even more than that, just to get excited about it, right? The lights and the motion, you want to learn more about it. And you have that in your mind when you're a little kid, like, oh man, I remember a couple of years ago when I saw this at an Innovators Fair or a Maker Fair, like, I really want to understand more about that. And they've got that drive to learn on their own as they get older. That's what all these amazing products at the Young Innovators Fair will help these kids do as they get older.
I mean, I feel like, I mean, my childhood was just impaired with respect to what kids have.
God, I wish I was. Yeah, I know. We were 30 years ago, we had these tools. It would be amazing.
By the time they're like 20 or 30 years old and working on things, they're going to be doing things so far beyond. I mean, by the time they're 12, they're doing things far beyond.
Yeah, they'll be experts in their field before they're professionals. Absolutely.
There are 10 and 12-year-olds that can code better than I can, Arduinos, right. And they're already far past me.
Piloting starships,
Exactly. I tell them, I mean, seriously, they're the next generation of engineers and scientists that are going to help us out. When we are 60, 70, we have Alzheimer's, we have Parkinson's, we need spinal cord implants.
Yeah.
We need to get these kids excited about it now.
So they develop. Can help us when we need it.
Right? That's the goal. They're going to be the scientists that actually can help out.
I also feel like science fiction told them that there was this world out there of space travel and all the rest of it that was that accessible.
We were promised jetpacks.
And then when they realized, they're like, oh, it's not here yet?
Yeah. These are the building blocks, so they can build that stuff as they get older. It's amazing. It really is.
All right, so neurotinker.com, and you've got your booth here today, and things are coming out soon.
So for the teachers that are listening, we'll be at the National Science Teacher Association events this coming fall, probably in Baltimore, NABT, Association of Biology Teachers, St. Louis in November. So getting to those formal education events as well. Neurotinker.com is the best initial place to find out more about us. Contact us for more information.
And important, I was saying this earlier today, when I was growing up, science was a class that I think showed up in ninth grade or eighth grade or something specifically. And my 10-year-old daughter, through fourth grade, had one period a day that was a dedicated science class. So we need more of these tools in the classroom to do this education, because this is now a normal part of the curriculum.
It is.
It's not something reserved for someday you may be interested in this really hard.
Or if time. Yeah.
If we have time
and budget. Between reading and math, we'll get to the science. Yeah.
That's exactly right. It is part of their expectations now, what they're going to learn at that level, which is amazing.
I love it. Thank you so much for joining us
Thank
today.
You.
I really
Fantastic.
Appreciate getting Thank to
Thank you
talk
for coming
with
up
you.
With such a brilliant idea. I can't wait to see this.
So Zach, my engineer, he'll be listening to this. He's the one that came up with the initial prototype. Amount of thanks to him, too, for helping us get to this point.
Yeah. And I want one to play with.
We all want some. I need 100 billion of them to develop a new brain that I'm going to be needing soon. As a parent of a 10 or 5-year-old, I could use another brain sometimes.
I understand that very well. Absolutely. Yeah, I can't. I want to play with these things. They're so fun.
We're looking forward to more people actually getting that hands-on experience very soon. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yep, thank you.
Get back to your booth. I know you're the only one over there.
I want to learn about the brain.
Thanks for coming out to the Young Innovators Fair, too.
Thank you.
This is wonderful. I hope a lot of kids and adults are getting excited.
I think so. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Take care. Bye. This is This Week in Science, and we are interviewing innovators all day today. We're having such a good time. I'm hearing about so many amazing projects, so many innovations, so many ideas, and I hope that you guys out there are enjoying it as well. Do you know what it's time for? Do I know what it's time for?
It's time to learn about 3D printing.
Yes!
That are kind of mind-bending a little bit.
What is this 3D printing you talk about?
It's not mind-bending.
Biological.
It's not made out of plastic.
Biological 3D printing.
Yes, Kevin, please come on up. We are going to be joined up here right now by Kevin, who works with a company called BioBots.
Here, let's make some space on the table for this
contraption. Yeah, we need some space on the table for this one, for the contraption. It's not actually going to print for us today.
Oh, man.
I know. But
no bones about it.
It's good to have a device that we can point at and say, look at the dilly boober lurber. Come on in. Hi there.
How are you?
Great. How are you doing?
Okay.
Can you introduce yourself?
My name is Kevin Mitchell. I build 3D printers, biomedical printers for BioBots. I do all the assembly and testing, and we do a bunch of accuracy tests for each machine before they go out.
All right. So we've seen many 3D printers. You know, we've got the plastic extruding 3D printers. We've got the powder that gets, there are lots of different kinds of 3D printers. But this is, the BioBot is different. Can you explain how it's different?
It works on the same principle, but you have syringes that you load up with living cells, and then you have another set that you load up with a scaffolding material. Okay. And if you were to just take cells, living cells, and put them in a mold and try to form them into a shape, they would die because there's no nutrients. They don't have the ability to get the nutrients to flow through.
Right.
So by putting it in a scaffolding, you're allowing the oxygen and nutrients to flow through. So it prints in alternate layers.
Okay, so is it usually single cell types? So say what are some of the things that you can print?
Pretty much every body part they've been able to do. You can print bone, cartilage, heart muscle, kidney, liver.
So you've got single muscle cells.
Right.
Bone, you've got osteoclasts. Single bone cells.
Right.
Kidney, liver, these are a little bit more complex organisms with different cell types. How do you deal with the fact that you're printing? Those are organs.
Right.
How does that work?
Making a viable organ that would be transplantable is not possible yet for most things. They have done bladder, which is very simple. You know, one cell type. And this particular model that I brought with me today only has two extruders.
Okay.
They are working on a new model getting ready to come out, which has six extruders, so that they can print more materials at one time.
Yeah, because one of the interesting things, I do a stem cell podcast also, and one of the difficulties of understanding organ systems and cellular development is the fact that cells don't do things by themselves. They're part of a complex system. And so you have one cell doing one thing, a different kind of cell doing another thing, but they're talking to each other to help each other and work together to create the whole.
Right.
So when you just put them together and print them together and give them the right nutrient bath, and then everything works?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm not on the biological side. I'm not a biologist. I'm more...
You build the 3D printers.
Yeah, the testing. And I've kind of a hobbyist programmer, so I can go in and tweak the software a little bit. I'm not really into the biology side of it. I have a lot of interest in it. I find it fascinating, but that's really not my expertise.
Got it.
When you've printed this kidney or this thing, is this something that's actually alive?
Yes.
I just wanted to say that.
The eventual goal, and a lot of people think it's going to be about 10 to 15 years away before they can actually make viable organs. But the eventual goal is to make transplantable organs, and they take cells from the person's own body, so there's no drug rejection. Just alone, 120,000 people die every year on the transplant lists, and they just can't get an organ.
They're just waiting.
So, yeah,
exactly.
So it's going to save a lot of lives once they do get to that point.
And
right now, what it's mostly being used for is testing. Like, they can print skin,
right?
And that's eliminating the need to test on animals. And
oh, that's interesting.
A lot more accurate, because you're testing on human skin as opposed to an animal, which may not translate. So for cosmetics, it's big. They can take tumors from a person's body and grow that tumor and then test drugs against each of it.
Wow,
and see which personalized medicine, which drug is going to work for you.
Wow.
And for that tumor.
Wow, so that's huge.
A lot of different uses that are happening right now, but the end goal is eventually to be able to grow organs.
Yeah, from, like you said, a person's own cells.
Right.
So, like, not having rejection is huge because your immune system doesn't like things from other bodies, from other people. And so if you, say, you need a bone graft, you've had an accident or cancer and you've lost part of your bone, you need to have a new bone put in to replace it. If you can have your own bone as opposed to cadaverous bone, then you're not going to reject it. You're not going to have to be on anti-rejection drugs that reduce the usefulness of your immune system against other infectious diseases.
Right.
Although, if you have an immediate family member, it's still difficult because you'd have to talk them out of their bones, which most people aren't willing to donate. A kidney, maybe they'll give you.
You don't have, your own bone. You get a piece of your own bone and grow it. You grow the cells, like bone stem cells. You grow them in a dish, and then you use them and print the bone, right? Yes. So this is going to rely on technologies of growing stem cells to get cells from people.
Right.
In the quantities that are large enough to be able to do the 3D printing in the first place. Like, what kind of quantities are we looking at? What do you?
That I'm not sure.
No, it's interesting. Can we bring the 3D printer up here and look at it? I'd love to see it. It really does kind of, it just looks like a 3D printer. It's got kind of a MakerBot exterior. The 3D printer case. Yeah, let's make sure I've got it in the frame.
Look, Blair, there's your replicator.
Yeah. Here's your replicator. Yes. Could you make a hamburger with it?
I wouldn't want to eat it, but so you see here you've got two separate extruders, and they're regular needles, and they just drop in. So you put whatever material you're planning to print in here, and this particular material is pleuronic, and that's the scaffolding material. So
okay. What is the scaffolding material made of?
It's called pleuronic.
Pleuronic?
Yes. And that
Is it a polymer?
Not sure exactly what it's from.
Okay.
But it acts as a scaffolding and as a nutrient and allows the nutrients to flow through. So like I said, if you just dump the cells into a clump, they're going to die. This way they can feed off of that. And as the cells multiply, they're absorbing the pleuronic. And once it's all gone, there's nothing but the organ left.
Right. You don't need the scaffolding anymore, and the cells are maintaining themselves.
Right.
Right.
And then there's also PCL plastic. I didn't bring the metal syringe with me, but you can put this in there. And these things, both these tubes heat up. So you can put a metal syringe in there, put this PCL plastic in there, which is biocompatible.
Right.
And it can be used in the body, like these here. I'll show you these. These are trachea.
Trachea.
There was an infant that was born with a weak trachea that was collapsing.
Yes.
So they printed these, put that in, and after a few weeks it dissolves, but that gave time for her trachea to grow and support itself.
So the trachea is mostly cartilage and connective tissue.
Right.
Right? Yeah.
And this one girl was, wasn't strong enough, so it was collapsing.
Yeah.
So they just put this in to hold it in place. So.
Wow. How long does it take to dissolve? Just a few weeks?
I think
weeks?
It's about 6 weeks.
6 weeks? Okay. Yeah, I remember when that story came out. And Yeah, the first 3D printed trachea. Yeah. Yeah, it's so, but you know, such a simple, it seems like such a simple thing now, and that it's so, it's life-saving.
Yeah.
And I imagine this is the kind of thing that could be used not just for infants, but for any accident victims, people who maybe they've had a tracheotomy and, you know, you can go in and fix it.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's amazing. Yeah, I've read other stories about the PCL, this absorbable body, bioabsorbable plastic, biocompatible, I guess. They're also using it to print scaffolding or for bone regrowth, right. Looking at things like spinal cord injuries, for nerve regrowth, to create channels that you can seed with nerve cells and allow nerves to grow down the channels to reconnect with the other ends of the severed nerves.
Right.
Did you use it as a scaffold for a ventricle, for a fake heart, something like that? I want to say.
I don't know if they have. You probably could. Yeah, and then print the heart muscle around, and then put that around the heart muscle.
Yeah. The one thing that separates BioBots from everybody else, what they have a patent on, what really set them apart, there's actually an LED on here that it's a UV light that cures the material. So prior to that, they were trying to use heat to cure the scaffolding material, and that was killing the cells.
Right.
So what they're doing is they're using the light to cure this material. So.
And that's a good development, because it's going to allow the cells to survive. You're going to have healthy tissue. You're going to have scaffolding that works.
Right.
All the pieces start working together. This is so cool. And it's small.
Yeah. It's small enough to fit inside of a hood for cleanliness, you know, to keep it sterile.
Yeah, so. I was really surprised at the size. It's portable.
Yeah.
It could be taken places that are where it's needed. How big is the, you're saying that they're going to start producing a six syringe model. How much bigger would that be?
It's only slightly bigger. It's a little bit wider. I think maybe a little bit deeper. They haven't started shipping yet. It's still in production.
Right.
But it's not much bigger.
So regular 3D printers, you can buy one for like $300 for a very basic model. You can buy much more expensive ones if you want. What kind of a price? I mean, am I going to be able to have a BioBot in my
this
garage?
This one goes for
$10,000, yeah.
But by comparison,
you could, $10,000 when it comes to lab equipment, that's not.
By comparison to everything.
In terms of medical equipment, yeah, that's very cheap.
It's cheap.
Yeah.
Yeah, all the larger machines prior to this were much more expensive. So it's.
And what kind of, so yes, this is the extruder. You can build it, but what does it connect to on the computer side? Like, is what kind of computer software requirements are?
They have their own dedicated software.
Okay.
It's USB, so it just hooks up right to a regular computer. It's nothing. Yeah.
Eventually, it'll just be an app on their iPhone.
Yeah.
I would like. Oh, I need a pancreas. Thank you very much.
one of the things that BioBots has done, which I think is very smart, is they've started a community. So there's a lot of feedback between them and their customers, and they're constantly iterating on that and putting that feedback into their designs. So it's working out well.
Yeah, so it's constantly improving based on the needs of the users.
Right.
This is fabulous. And I'm sure it's going to be used a lot, not only in the biomedical application setting, such as in saving the lives of infants, but it's also going to be in the research, the clinical setting, being able to, like you said, do tests on drugs, print an organ, see how drugs work on it.
Yeah.
And of all the uses for 3D printing that have come about, this I did not see as a possibility, creating something that's alive. That's really amazing.
I know. Next, we need one that can make me a grilled cheese sandwich.
You know, I said, now that seems easier to me. I mean, that part, because you
it's
don't
layers
have to,
at least, you know, you've got the bread layered, layer, the cheese layer.
But you don't
heard it. They had a 3D printer that printed a pizza.
Wait, what?
Yeah, we reported on the show about it. It was a while ago. I'm going to find it. But yeah, they had a 3D printer that printed a pizza. They said it didn't taste good, but they printed it. They did it, and it was edible. And that's what's important.
Oh, yeah, just that it was edible.
Yeah, I think the biggest challenge right now for making viable organs is the vasculature. It's so small, and that's the big challenge at this point.
Is the are you going to be do you know if they're going to be putting cells for vasculature into some of the few, like, because with two extruders you're obviously not going to have that ability, but with six, could you potentially lay down the framework within the scaffolding for veins?
I'm not sure.
Yeah. I don't know. That would be interesting. Yeah. Epithelial cells. Get them in there. Get some vasculature. See what they do. See how the cells talk to each other and what they want to do. This is awesome. I'm sure also that somebody's going to start using it and come up with some use that nobody ever considered.
Yeah.
Have there been any surprises that you're aware of in, like, in the community as far as what people are doing with them?
No, I'm not really too aware of that side of it.
Okay.
I deal mostly, like I said, with the assembly, and I give them a lot of feedback on things I think they can improve on and improve the assembly process and things like that.
So what are your margins of error for, I mean, this has got to be fairly accurate. Cells are magnification scale. You can't see them with the naked eye. So, I mean, you're printing things that are tiny.
I believe this one is 10 microns. And the next one is below 1 micron.
Wow. So the engineering challenge there to get that accuracy. What's that like for you?
Wait, what is it? I need some definition. 1 micron versus a human hair.
I think a human hair is like...
3?
Yeah.
Thickness of 3 microns?
Small. 20, maybe. Maybe a human hair is 20 microns. No. I don't know. I don't know.
But it's gonna be down to, like you said, a degree in which you can't see and with the human eye. So all of this, of course, we're gonna rely on the computer to put everything in the right place and have a machine refined enough to be able to place it there. That's fascinating.
Is there a camera in it, or is it?
This one does not have it. The next one actually does, and it can actually look at the cells and count the number of cells. It has a
cell count while placing?
While it's printing, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So cell by cell, it'll be watching its own work.
Right.
And are you going to be implementing any kind of self-management or, like, robotic self-control? I've placed this many cells. And
yeah, I'm not sure about the software end of it. I haven't seen the software for the new machine. So.
Okay. It seems so cool. Yeah. How do you make something that accurate?
Most of the machines out there on the market tend to use rails and belts, but because they're using screw-driven actuators, it's much more accurate.
Okay.
Actually, as part of the assembly process, once the machine's done, I print different tests, and then I also use a gauge, and it moves, checks all three axes for accuracy. In my test, it was so accurate, I need a more accurate testing machine. So
broke the testing machine.
Yeah, it's impressive how accurate it is. So
that is impressive. I love it. Thank you so much for bringing this by today.
Thank you for having me on.
You're welcome. And I hope a lot more people will start talking about biobots. And
yeah,
this is like the next level of 3D printing. It's just I'm looking at it going, wow.
Yeah, it sounds like, what do you say, 120,000, 130,000 people on a waiting list, and that's just one application that this could be helping out people. I'm sure there's many, many, many more once we get this out into the, once we get this first round of tackling the first wave of problems. That sounds like a lot of solutions are hiding in here.
Yep. It's just going to take creativity of the biology, of the biomedical community. What are they going to do? Thank you so much.
All right, thank you.
Great talking with you, Kevin. You thanks for bringing it by. Also, it's great to have the visual aid to see exactly what's going on inside of here. The biobots. Seriously, $10,000 is not much compared to other medical equipment. No. Man. This is impressive. And it's pretty. Pretty design, wonderful purpose. This is This Week in Science. We were just talking with Kevin, who works with BioBots to manufacture the BioBots, biological 3D printing, cell by cell.
3D printed human organs.
Skin. I love that he brought us little tracheas. Little,
yes.
Here's a trachea for you.
Yeah, they were a little bit chewier than I expected them to be.
Right. Let's chew on it.
Yeah, I was telling Justin they kind of looked like calamari.
That I was not expecting to see here.
Yeah.
That is wild.
It's going to revolutionize. That's what everyone always says, right? This is going to revolutionize medical care. But that actually will.
Yeah.
It actually will.
When you can go to your doctor and have them print you up a new whatever it is organ that's not working right.
Out of your own cells.
Yeah. That was right. That right there is the future of medicine.
Yeah. Absolutely.
There's something wrong with the system. You know what? Instead of treating you with a drug, instead of going ahead and just doing this or that for the symptoms.
Just take out my kidney.
We're just going to take it out completely. We're going to print you a brand new one.
Start over.
And in fact,
let's call a mulligan on this kidney.
In fact, you can really just start to think about this in terms of aging. You know, Mr. Jackson, you could probably go another 6 years on that liver. But at some point, you're going to need a new one.
Yeah,
so we're going to go ahead and start the printing process now. We're going to start collecting your cells. Maybe about 3 months from now, we'll just get brand new liver.
Some of the new methodologies for creating batches of stem cells are really speeding up the process for getting more stem cells more quickly. And so the possibility, maybe it won't be 3 months. Maybe it'll be a week. Maybe it'll be 3 days to get new things. Bye, Kevin. See you later. There goes BioBots out of the building. There goes the future of medicine. Exactly.
And you saw it here first, or maybe you went to the booth and saw it there first.
They don't have a booth. They came just for us.
Oh, really?
All right. We have another guest. He's wandering around in circles. Brian, if you want to come up, we've got stairs over here. If you want to come join us up on stage.
Down.
Do you want to put him over there or you want to sit here? You'll move wherever you want to be. All right. This is This Week in Science. We hope everyone's enjoying the Young Innovators Fair. Lots of innovations going on here. Right now... Oh, I got a poster from this guy earlier. They're amazing posters. I'd like to welcome Brian Yetzer to This Week in Science. He has a company called Yetzer Studios, and it's a design studio, but he is working on integrating science and art, science and technology. What's going on? Are we getting a picture?
Getting a paparazzi.
Oh, we're taking
a
paparazzi moment.
We have to document this moment in time.
Oh my goodness, I love this. So I'm seeing something that I love.
It's probably my favorite
sciencey thing of all times, which is a Tesla coil.
Yeah. So Brian, can you introduce yourself and what you've brought here today to the Young Innovators Fair?
Well, first of all, I want to say it's a pleasure to be here, and I appreciate the opportunity to be interviewed. It's very exciting. I feel like I have a purpose to be here in the sense that I'm...
Just closer to your mouth.
Okay.
There you go.
The purpose of being here is to spread the message of Nikola Tesla through art, technology, and design. And I think it's a very important time to bring awareness to Tesla and his... ideas of renewable energy during this day and age. So it's an honor to be here with all three of you on this stage.
Thank you.
Yeah, so Tesla had the idea that you could produce energy, put it freely through the air, and people could just power their devices remotely, although nobody really liked the idea because then how do you charge for it? You couldn't get that sponsored at the time.
Yeah, everybody likes free things except the people who want to make money.
Except the people producing the energy.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
You can't, survive by breathing air only. And unfortunately, because Tesla was a humanitarian, He was a scientist humanitarian. Some may argue that he wasn't the best business person or marketer. Some may also say that he had a quirky personality and he was a little out there. But I believe
maybe not so social.
He is the favorite scientist amongst pigeons.
Pigeons.
I did not bring the chess set, but there's a 3D printed Nikola Tesla chess set that's at the booth. So it's magnetized and you can actually play it on a wall.
Nice.
But the pigeon is the pawn.
Yeah.
Excellent.
He's the god of
pigeons in there somewhere.
Or his closest friends at one point. Yeah.
So you've made a bunch of posters. You've got a bunch of things here. I came by and was really struck by the beauty of the posters that you've developed. And you're the designer?
That's correct.
So can you tell us a little bit about what brought you to create these posters and they're more than just posters. What do they do?
Well, basically, we're living in a time when we're transcending from the physical to the virtual. So you may hear a lot of virtual reality talk. You'll also hear more AR or augmented reality talk thanks to Pokemon Go and Snapchat. So I saw the writing on the wall in 2010 with augmented reality. That was the same year I learned about Nikola Tesla. That was the same year they had the Gulf oil spill, the Deep Horizon BP oil spill. So he had an eco disaster. At the same time, I'm learning about Nikola Tesla. And I saw augmented reality as rising technology. And at the time, it was on webcams. Only workstations could power these experiences that sort of gave us a realistic look or experience.
Right.
But I saw mobile devices. By the way, this is a Tesla coil inspired design phone case.
Nice.
I saw mobile devices taking off, and I saw the processing power, and I saw augmented reality as an opportunity to bring people into the world of Tesla. So being trained as a traditional artist and designer, but at the time I was teaching university level 3D modeling, animation, visual effects, image manipulation. Let's merge all of these disciplines and create an interactive poster series that would explain Tesla from who he was to the famous Tesla coil and then the Tesla coil big size 187 foot tall Warden Cliff Tower. This project was destined to be part of the traveling exhibit called Tesla Past, Present, Future. And so the traveling exhibition would make a rounds in universities and public spaces, and the interactivity would be from people downloading on their mobile device the free app and then getting the content appearing from the posters or banners, 6 foot tall banners, and the banners would come to life.
So can we demonstrate this? Like maybe Justin can hold a poster up for the camera over here. And then if you can turn on your device and we can kind of see how this works. I hope it'll work for the...
So what you're going to do is you're going to download the free app from the iOS or Android app stores. It's called Nikola Tesla AR. It looks like this book cover. That's the icon. You'll see it on the app stores. What you're going to do is you're going to launch the app, and you're going to scan the app or the poster, and you'll see an augmented reality Tesla coil that you can have spark. So this is why Tesla was considered a mad scientist, because
that
of the sparking,
awesome.
The sparking Tesla coil.
I can see it.
You have to see it over on the other side. It's just so amazing on this side. So you've got the sparking Tesla coil, and I can see down here you've also got the arcs on the other end of the device. What is this showing?
So this is the magnetic field that appears We have a magnetic field around the earth. This has a magnetic field around the primary and secondary coil. And I talk like I'm a Tesla coil expert at this point. I should be, right? Because I've had to interface. Let me go ahead and turn off the sparking effects. I worked with an expert in Tesla coil technology. I didn't know how a Tesla coil worked. But he explained how electricity flows through the device step by step from 120 volts all the way to the transformer, all the way to the capacitor batteries. All of this had to be content verified. I had no idea how a Tesla coil operated. I'm not an electrical engineer, and I'm an interpreter. I interpret subject matter expert knowledge to software and combine that with art. And so what we have here is the electricity being amplified from 120 volts from the outlet all the way up to the toroidal object that could be up to 200,000 or more volts. So you'll see that the capacitor batteries are growing in intensity, and it'll ramp up to the secondary coil until it finally sparks. So it wasn't just about showing a cool Tesla coil in augmented reality. It was about explaining a process. And this can be transferable to other apps. So my company produces AR experiences that helps explain complex topics for easy comprehension.
I love it. Right. So it gets people to actually get into. And so it just takes this 2D experience,
yes,
turns it into a 3D experience that they
and
can
allows
really
you to play with
a
Tesla coil at home and not be zapping the
right, less
guy.
Dangerous for the average
dangerous.
Person.
A little less dangerous.
Exactly. And I just wanted to let you know that this artwork is available through the store, but ultimately the funding of this project will expand the app to include more Tesla inventions. Tesla himself obviously requires his own poster, right? So in this book.
Yep, yeah, you got it.
This book, Lightning Strikes, Timeless Lessons in Creativity from the Life and Work of Nikola Tesla, now available in Barnes & Nobles and on Amazon, includes the interactive artwork.
So did you work with this this Tesla expert who wrote the book to...
The author, he writes for Forbes. He's a financial guy. He caught wind of Tesla. He said, I want to write a book about him. He flies from Chicago to Philadelphia 2 years ago. We are firing off Tesla coils on Tesla's birthday on July 9th, reciting the Declaration of Energy Independence. And he says, Brian, I love your work. It's beautiful. It's interactive. I want it in my book. So it came to be, I end up in a meeting with them in New York, and they said, well, we want to include it as a color insert. And so what you can do is you can open up to page 149, launch the app, and the book becomes like a virtual pop-up book. And it's very exciting. It's
Let
me go ahead and launch the app, and I'll show you here. Thank you.
So now all of, just like the posters, all of these inserts in the book suddenly become three-dimensional, and you can get the sparking Tesla coil in your book.
That is so cool.
We have a video documentary. The video itself has been provided by the Tesla Memorial Society of New York. And you can play back a short documentary from this page or poster or... Actually, from the t-shirt itself. So what we have here is an interactive t-shirt. There's another design that actually plays back how the Tesla coil works from a t-shirt.
This is all so, this is so creative. I love the way this all works together.
Thank you very much. This is the Wardenclyffe property, the Wardenclyffe Tower. So I've been explaining to the attendees here at the event the importance of the Tesla coil to demonstrate the transmission of wireless electricity. But on a much larger scale, we have the Wardenclyffe Tower, and that was to transmit electricity and communications through a system of Tesla towers around the world, harnessing Earth's natural resources, renewable energies like the sun, transmitting that energy electricity that we can all share and use. So the idea of going to war for non-renewables is non-existent. The idea of not having to pay a phone bill, the idea of not having to pay an electric bill, the idea of never having to pump your gas again, the idea you're driving down the road and your car powers up wirelessly through this ether of power is Tesla's dream that was never fully realized. So to be here at this event showcasing this STEAM project via augmented reality, which was soon to transform our consciousness, virtual and augmented reality technologies are taking off now. We'll soon be going from the tablets to the headsets.
Right, it'll be VR.
And then it'll be invisible by 15 to 20 years. But that's when the singularity event takes place.
And the amazing thing, too, is, you know, Tesla's often thought of as a man ahead of his time. Here we are 100 years later. He's still ahead of us.
He's still ahead of his time 100 years later. We still haven't caught up to these dreams yet. We still haven't gotten there. People are working on it. The dream is still alive. Like what you're talking about, the dream of this wireless electricity, the dream of limitless power, it's still alive and people are absolutely working on it. But it's amazing that 100 years later, we're still not there.
There's a lot of manipulation to keep the control over the masses. You need to promote war and fear in order to take resources from another country. And also, if it's not to go in other countries, it's to dig domestically. So what happens is we poison our own water systems or our own environment here in the United States.
Yeah. There's a great example of this in the story of Tesla, which is there was he had tried to give alternating current to Edison.
Yes.
And Edison already had direct current. He was invested in this, and so he didn't want to change it, and he kicked him out of his lab.
And then there's Edison, who's a good salesman.
Well, and then Edison brought along Topsy the elephant. As long with lots of stray dogs that they could catch in New York City,
that's right.
Would electrocute them with alternating current,
yes,
to show the dangers of alternating current, even though it was less dangerous, and it took longer to kill these animals. And in fact, that's how we ended up with an electric chair. It was a negative publicity stunt that was created by Edison to try to scare people off of Tesla's invention. And so you have this horrible, and of course, direct current ended in more house fires. It was much more difficult thing to actually implement into people's homes.
But it wasn't Edison's idea, so he's saying that I'm saying the alternating current wasn't Edison's idea,
right?
So he just wasn't interested. And he's
idea
like,
he didn't have any proprietary ownership over.
Yeah.
And so it's that desire to control resources. Or that's been creating this stagnation and getting to this point that you're talking about, where electricity can be democratized, where the energy that's already out there can be democratized, and people can have access to it without having to go through somebody who has a proprietary ownership of that system.
I'm excited about new technologies like solar roof panels. The Tesla company now, Elon Musk's company, Solar City, they merged with Solar City, they're working on solar roof panels that from there could potentially charge the Tesla wall battery. They've got their batteries that they're also selling. You could have your own power. We were talking yesterday about a new catalyst for splitting water and carbon dioxide, so you could have an efficient hydrogen cell in your house powered by the power of the sun with batteries to hold that energy after you've split those molecules and created the energy, and you wouldn't need to be on the grid at all. These technologies are coming. They're coming. I think it'll be there eventually, but I think it's very exciting. But I love the fact that you're trying to educate people on these Tesla technologies, his coil from 100 years ago, through this art and design and being able to use it as a stepping stone to get into the story of Tesla, to figure out how the technologies work so you can actually people will want to delve more into the history and also into the technology itself.
Yeah, so as an artist and designer, it's a real treat to be able to merge the physical with the virtual at a time when we're transcending from the physical to the virtual consciously.
That's interesting, yeah.
So what we're having here is a physical product that ties with a virtual product. And eventually, perhaps, our consciousness transcends to 100% virtual, and nothing will be physical again.
No, I don't like that.
We see the minimalist movement now, where everyone is, the ego has always wanted, well, not generalizing, but the 90s ego, in my opinion, the Hummer vehicle, for example, was the pinnacle of consumerism, the waste of the, we need to have the McMansion, we need to have many items to feel fulfilled. The idea of being able now to go in the opposite direction and say, how much do I really need to be happy, kind of comes into play. What is the, so going back to being the artist, to have canvas, to have prints, to have banners, to have t-shirts, sure, it's a launching pad to delve deeper into Tesla. I'm not speaking specifically about Tesla, but any concept to help educate our population using technology in a positive way. If I really wanted to make some money in this business, I would probably already develop some sort of zombie game where there's headshots to be.
Right.
Yeah, and I appreciate that you put your talents to, I think, a much higher principled use.
Well, and I see this also as a great reason to own a book as opposed to get your, you know, to get it on your Kindle or whatever it is. This is a great motivation to own an actual physical thing to use with your technology, which is still awesome, but it's a nice interface with real material things.
Exactly. The idea that the artwork can stand on its own in a gallery, but the idea that gallery visitors can download the free app and then their consciousness can become expanded. Yeah, that's being here at this event, I've been able to really affect people in the sense that I can tell the story of Tesla, but also say that we could have been down a much more productive, less destructive path. And it really, you can see like people's minds clicking, going like, whoa, really? That's, and you feel good about yourself as a result. You're saying all this hard work to really understand how a Tesla coil works. Who was Nikola Tesla? Wardenclyffe, what did it all mean? And then also all the years of painstaking research into the software development, mobile tech, changing constantly every day. It just came to be right now, and it's very exciting.
It seems very exciting. Thank you so much for joining us.
Really,
this was really
work.
Fun. Thanks for demonstrating your poster and showing us the book. And I hope
where can people find you? Where can people find your work?
Where can we find you?
Yetzerstudio.com. Yetzerstudio.com. And if you purchase this book, Lightning Strikes, on the leaflet. Let's see.
Need help?
On the leaflet, there's instructions on how to download the app, where to download the app from.
Right.
Unlock this book's interactive 3D animation and videos honoring Tesla's life and legacy with Yetzer Studios' free Nikola Tesla augmented reality app. Gives the URL,
right.
YetzerStudio.com. I also want to say it's an honor to be in a book like this because
absolutely,
there's a little blurb in the book, a paragraph written about me and this project, which is great because it's also mentioning Elon Musk and other people.
Visionaries.
That's I'm very honored and happy to be a part of it.
That's fantastic. Thank you so much. It was really wonderful to get to speak with you and see your art demonstrated. And yeah, I hope it touches many people.
Thank you very much for your time.
Yeah, thank you. All righty, everybody. This is This Week in Science. We're at the Young Innovators Fair. We're coming up on the last hour of the fair. I can't believe it's happening already. It's been such a wonderful weekend, and we're having so much fun. All right, we got posters. Yay, thank you so much. That was Brian Yetzer from Yetzer Studios, and he's made these amazing augmented reality posters and inserts for the book Lightning Strikes.
Yeah, I can totally picture hanging one of those in my house and then telling somebody, do you want to see something cool?
Do you want to see something really neat? Yeah, super fun.
Yeah,
absolutely. Oh, my goodness.
All right.
So we are This Week in Science. This Week in Science is a weekly science news podcast. I'm Kiki Sanford, Dr. Kiki. That's Blair.
I'm Blair. Justin will be back any moment.
Oh, he's walking behind us.
There he is.
Yeah.
And we have one more scheduled interview. Maybe we'll catch a few more before the end of the day. But we have Ventech here. You guys can come up the stairs
on in
here.
Why don't you tell me about these things, interviews?
It's on the ring.
I can't see it from over here.
I run the list.
Are we 15 minutes late for them? Or are we on time for them? I like being on time. We're on time. We're not starting late.
All
That's
right.
Great.
So, let's see. Right center.
Microphone. You have to kind of hold them closer to your mouth to actually be heard out that way. I feel like I'm yelling all the time. So, introduce yourselves.
I'm Anshu Garg. I work for Ventech Solutions. We're an IT federal government contractor, so we build software solutions for federal government, for Medicare, Medicaid, Department of Defense. So pretty cool stuff. I joined Ventech about 3-4 months ago as their youth innovation lead. So okay. I specifically work with their high schoolers and college kids to inspire them to innovate and come up with brand new application ideas or product ideas. And, we have students come into our offices, work with our developers, work with our employees to really get their idea out in the market and explore different ideas. Yeah.
That's neat. And you?
My name is Lucy Schoenberg, and I am actually the team leader of our Ventech.
Is that on? Hold on. Let's make sure. You might have turned it off.
Can you start over?
Start over.
Yeah, so my name is Rasheed Kunduru, and I'm actually the team leader of our Ventech Youth Innovation Team.
Okay.
And that's just a team we have at Ventech that brainstorms some ideas and tries to, make things happen. And we're all in high school. So I lead that team, and we just have a blast.
Okay, so you've started. How did you? Are you an innovator?
So,
how did you get this job? What brought you to this?
So I actually run a week-long summer camp every year for the past 7 years. I've been running a week-long summer camp at my nonprofit organization for about 120 campers aged 8 through 15. And I recruit about 45 counselors to help me run this week-long camp, and they stay overnight the whole 7 days. And the founder of the company that I work for now, Ventech Solutions, has two sons that have attended
the camp. Okay.
And so he's actually known me for quite some time, about 15, 17 years.
All right.
So he's known me for quite a long time. Before this, I was actually at JPMorgan Chase as an IT risk manager. So he recently had an idea to start.
I have to say, that's a little less interesting job title.
I'm telling you, yes, it is, yes. For sure. That's what everybody tells me, actually.
Yeah.
So him and I had an idea over last summer. We're like, hey, let's get some of our youth together and, have them not waste time over the summer and see if they can come up with some crazy ideas. And, hey, maybe they might become something big. So we gathered about 6 or 7 of them, created a group in Columbus, Ohio. We flew down from Columbus, Ohio, actually, just for this. They spent about 400 or 500 hours from last summer to come up with about a list of 10 different mobile application ideas, one of which the CEO actually really loved. So right now they are going to be working with our intellectual property lawyers and patent lawyers to see where it can take them next. So, they'll be working with our developers and our SharePoint designers and all that to really come up with the next steps to commercializing this product.
And so this is a product that's really, it's going to help people in these healthcare areas. So in Medicare, Medicaid.
So what the application ideas were is that the CEO actually wanted the kids to come up with something that has nothing to do with the company at all.
Oh, okay. So just come up with a new idea, just something.
He's
Wow.
He's a big believer in what we call free thinking.
Okay.
So the mentality of school, we find very basic. You know, what's on the paper, you got to get done right on the paper. So like when you're doing math problems, you know, you're just doing math problems right on the paper. So they don't get to get inspired and use their creativity for, you know, other activities, which right. is why we're doing a program like this. So, you know, when they have open-ended, you know, I'm a big believer on, you know, when I bring students into the office, and I give them an Expo marker and they go to the whiteboard, they come up with crazy ideas. You know, their brain goes all over the place, especially when they have a big team. So they're working all together. It's quite interesting to see what type of ideas they come up with. And it's cool because I think that the older we get, the more logical we get. But I feel like logical right. isn't always the way to innovate.
It might not just be logical. It might just be stuck in our ways.
Yes, exactly. But these
I've done
not.
This the same way this many years. Right, I'm right. going to keep doing it.
Right, exactly. And the great part of these students is that they're not stuck in a way, right?
Right.
They can go anywhere. And that's what I love, and it inspires me every day to come watch these guys just get to a whiteboard and come up with crazy ideas.
Yeah. So, from your perspective on leading the team of these high school students, I mean, why did you get involved? Do you love coming up with crazy ideas? Are you always coming up with crazy ideas? How did you get involved
yeah,
in this?
Yeah. So earlier when he was talking about the two boys he knew from camp, the founder's children, I'm one of them.
Aha.
So we actually started, when we started, my dad actually told me about this and he said, this would be great for you. You're not doing anything this summer anyway, just try it. And I was like,
You're not doing anything, do this.
Yeah. But I've always been, you know, more of the creative type. I love playing with Legos since I was little. And I love like on Minecraft, like creating random things. And it's just always been fun for me to be innovative and creative. So, and I knew all the guys that were on my team already, and I just jumped in there and I was like, yeah, let's do this. So we have a blast, and we always, you know how we have different perspectives, I guess, when we think about something. So we it's a lot easier for us to innovate and think of different and new ideas.
Do you think the different people that you're working with, that do they have different strengths? And so from what kind of different areas of interest do people come from?
Of course. So there's always different strengths and weaknesses on a team, right? Is that everyone has different strengths and weaknesses. And I mean, a lot of people on the team, they like, you know, the computer aspect, like coding, mm-hmm. Like designing websites and stuff like that. There's one that's actually wants to be a mechanical engineer. Mm. One of them wants to be a doctor. I've always been into business and, you know, more like I'm more of a people person. So I like to do that instead of, you know, behind the screen and actually working something out. But we have a lot of different backgrounds, and that actually helps our ideas because they look at it from their own perspective and their own field of choice and how to make things better for everyone and not just like one group of people.
So do you start with a problem and then try to come up with solutions to it? Or do you just say, I have this crazy idea that so comes out of nowhere?
At first, it was we normally went through our day by day. So we're waking up. What's wrong with that? What can we change about waking up? Mm-hmm. Then we go to the bathroom and we're brushing our teeth. Is there anything that we want to change about that? Is there
right.
anything that we can improve? Is there anything that could, you know, we can make better? Then we're eating breakfast, and then, you know, we look for problems throughout that, like that. But sometimes when you're just living your life and you just get these sudden ideas, like why isn't my Coke can already cold right when I buy it from the store, right? Like, why can't it just be cold then? Or why do my shoes keep getting untied? Why can't I have something that keeps them tied and or ties mm-hmm. them for me when they get loose? So just stuff like that. And we share that with each other. And then when one person says an idea, it sparks other ideas in other
right.
people. You know, because they're looking at, again, from their perspective and their lens. So that's how we spark most of our ideas.
Where are you going to go with this? I mean, you said that you're working on the intellectual property and actually creating one of these ideas into a real app. But
so,
what's going to happen with this program?
Right now we're expanding. So we have about 6 locations in the U.S. We have a couple locations globally, I mean, outside of the U.S. also.
Yeah.
So we're expanding our team of groups because this is a fairly new group. So we're going to have about another 5 or 6 groups out in the U.S. With the same concept, you know, brainstorming, coming into the offices, working with our employees, and figuring out what problems are out there and how we can solve them. Currently, this team are working on screen designs. So, you know, they'll be working with our developers to take it to the next step and getting those prototype ready so they can test it internally within our company.
Right.
You know, and once all the patents and everything are completed. So eventually, you know, once we get the prototype out, we'd test it in a local area or a test market. And, you know, we'd spin up a subsidiary out of it, its own separate entity. And, you know, the best part is that these guys are all high schoolers. They're going to have their own company in high school.
I know. This is blowing my mind. I mean, I'm like, you're not even in college yet. And you're already like, I'm just working on business ideas. You know, I'm just going to do this thing.
Yeah, it's great.
Put on their college resume, CEO.
No, it's awesome because exactly. It's a great entry point into college because college is getting pretty competitive nowadays. So you need differing things, very competitive things and, you know, innovative things to put on there so that college can see that, hey, this guy is the right fit for this college.
Do you think getting an inside view of the idea formation, for company formation, for entrepreneurship, that this is, does it interest you to go into kind of the business side of things? Would you go down kind of like the I'm going to get an MBA kind of path and start my own businesses, or I don't need an MBA. I've already started 5 businesses before I was 21.
Yeah. So my dad has always been, you know, my big inspiration for me to actually start a business or a company or like that. So I've always wanted to do business ever since I was little. Okay. And, you know, what he does really does inspire me. And he's been starting businesses since he was 19 years old.
Wow. So he started at a young age too. That's pretty inspiring.
Been through several companies and several different businesses, you know, just to, always looking to, you know, make money and make a profit. But I think I'll be the same way. I might do higher education, but higher than college. I mean, right. I'll go to college, but after that, I'm not sure. I'm thinking I might stick to my businesses, or I might create some ideas. I might just, you know, go find some problems to solve.
Right. So, for college, what are you planning on doing?
College, I'm not so sure yet.
But what grade are you in?
I'm a sophomore in high school.
You still have a year, and, so you're all right.
Yeah. I've always been, along with business, been interested in aerospace science and aerospace engineering.
Nice.
And Ohio State's actually a very good college for that. So I'm from Ohio. And Ohio State's
and aerospace engineering is a great area right now. I mean, the new space industry is huge. SpaceX is just rocking it. Mm-hmm. SpaceX, I got a chance to visit Blue Origin recently and saw their rocket building facility and saw the new rockets that they're building. It's amazing stuff that they're working on. Yeah. So, I mean, there are companies all over the United States that are really pushing the envelope in terms of low Earth orbit vehicles, new vehicles to go to the moon, maybe go to Mars, new airplanes.
Yeah.
Maybe jets like the Concorde that don't have as much of a sonic boom so that people don't boycott.
Oh, yeah. Sure.
So many new ideas. So that would be a really lucrative industry to go into if you decide to go that way. Yeah. So many ideas. Wow. So what are you hoping to do? You're inspiring these young groups of kids during the summer, but is it a year-round process for you now?
Yes, it's continuing. So year-round, like I said, it's only been a few months for me that I've started. So this first team was very successful. So we're going to be expanding our groups. You know, I've already come up with the whole plan to recruit everybody, and we've already had ambassadors in each location that are going to be helping lead, you know, the same thing that we're doing in Columbus, Ohio.
Mm-hmm.
Eventually, I've talked to my CEO before too, and eventually, you know, I'm big on entrepreneurship as well, so which is why it was a great place for me to go, because I sit down with these kids and really vet these ideas through with them too. So, you know, eventually, I'm going to get into my own company business and see where it takes me from there.
Nice. I'm just thinking, are you going to be recruiting from all high schools? There's a lot of opportunities for kids who are in higher income areas, you know, the really good schools, you know, those kids, they got lots of opportunities. Are you going to go to low income areas and,
so, lower, yeah, so
and bring, try and bring kids, because this kind of a program could really give some students a leg up in a major way on their future.
Sure. I definitely agree. In terms of recruitment, I've had no restrictions in terms of who I go, where I go. We have started with local vicinities of where our offices are located, because
that makes sense.
I'm a firm believer in meeting in person and working together. I mean, I love the, you know, the FaceTiming and the video conferencing and all, but I feel like these kids are, and these students are a lot more productive when they're meeting in person and they're actually talking to one another, seeing their facial reactions, you know, and getting, you know, putting pen to paper. It's just, I just feel like they get a lot more out of it. So right now I'm going local vicinity. We are starting a global ideathon soon, which is our current thing I'm working on, which is a going to be a portal where anyone from adults all the way to kids can go down to and submit their own ideas that they have, work with our patent lawyers and our IP lawyers to see if it's an idea that they can take forward and commercialize with our Ventech Solutions developers and their you know, other employees that can help out. So that's definitely, that's underway too. So we're gonna go global soon.
Wow, that's fun, going global. So what are you guys here today, Young Innovators Fair, what have you had at your booth and what have you been showing people?
So today we have a group of four from Columbus, Ohio. Mm-hmm. It's actually part of my youth team that are running the booth right now. So I'm not running the booth, my youth are running
youth
the booth.
Youth, inspiring youth.
Yes, exactly, that's the best way. So right now we have Lego cars that they're building and they're powered by balloons. So we're racing them. We have a few mind games.
Gas power.
Yes, and we have three or four mind games to kind of encourage them that, you know, video games are fun, but so are board games. And board games that, you know, work your mind are much more fun. More fun that they sound boring, but when you get into it, they're like, wow. And it's funny, you know, all the parents that came up to me like, hey, can I buy one of these? I was like, oh, I'm not selling them, but buy one for your kid because he or she definitely enjoyed it. And it was great to see these kids, like these little kids doing these mind games and solving, you know, strategies for, you know, like Mastermind. Have you heard of Mastermind?
I have.
It's a code-breaking game. It's cool. And, you know, six-year-olds solving codes like that. It's really incredible to see how their mind works. And the kids were pretty excited when they solved the codes. And the parents were like, wow, this game is
so it's good for like six-year-olds even?
It says 8+, but me seeing like 6-year-olds, 7-year-olds solving these codes.
Your 6-year-old. Yeah, I'm gonna get this for my 6-year-old.
Yeah, it shows how, like, I mean, the logic building that they go through. I mean, it's incredible. It's incredible. So today we're here not to just sell anything or anything like that. We're here just to inspire.
I love it.
Yeah.
You've had great responses.
Great responses. We're so big. Actually, we haven't eaten all day. Because we've been
that
just
sounds
with the kids.
Like us, yeah.
We've been with the kids
food,
all
what
day.
Is food?
All day.
I am fueled by inspiration.
Yes, and all the passion that these kids have. It's great. It's great.
Well, thank you so much for telling us about what you're doing here today. I really appreciate you coming by here.
Definitely.
This is great.
Thanks for having us.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much.
Good luck in coming up with new innovations making ideas reality.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thanks for joining us. That is just great. That's great stuff. There are more and more of these groups people are putting together trying to get kids doing more stuff. Thank you so much once again. Have a wonderful afternoon. Safe trip back to Ohio.
And you notice once again, Minecraft came up.
Again, Minecraft.
Inspiring environment.
Minecraft has come up once again. We talked about Minecraft first thing yesterday.
Yeah, just about every kid who's come up here and talked about their inspiration for getting into programming or any other sort of thing, Minecraft has come up over and over and over again.
Oh, we've got the chat room going a little bit. We've got Ed from Connecticut in there. Yes, Ulysses, Janiscu. Hello, Wiz Mike. That's right. A few Protonic, according to Mouse, Rorks. I don't know who's actually in there and who's not. But hey, you guys in the chat room, good to see you there. People who might be tuning in over on Facebook and just kind of watching what we're doing today, thank you for joining us over on Facebook. It's been really fun. It is about 4:15 in the afternoon. We are into the last hour of the Youth Innovators Fair. We're having a great day. I haven't completely lost my voice. I think we've allowed other people to talk enough today that I haven't kind of helped a little bit.
Offset.
Yeah. Oh my goodness. So we are This Week in Science. We are a science news podcast on a weekly basis. Did you want to say hi?
Someone actually was.
If you had a question,
he has a very question. He's curious about the new camera that you got for us and what this thing is.
Aha! Uh-huh. So the camera we are using—we're broadcasting live to Facebook using this camera called a Mevo. It's M-E-V-O, and it's made by a company called Livestream, and you can have a Livestream account to broadcast directly to Livestream, but you can also use it to broadcast directly to Facebook. They're working on YouTube live streaming also, and Twitter and Periscope. But it is we have this wonderful app. You download the app to your iPhone or your iPad, and it's an immediate producer. So you can change the focus. It's a 4K camera, and so you can get a wide field view that's 4K, and then you can focus in on certain areas like faces, if I can get it to actually do that, get it on my face. It's called Mevo, M-E-V. It's the Mevo app, and you buy the camera, you download the app, and this is how, and it's what you use. It's an immediate producer, so you can to what? And you can record. You can record to an SD card that's in the Mevo. You can also so it'll record to the device, or you can have it save on whatever social media platform. You can use multiple cameras.
Oh my God, because this has been the problem forever, is getting a two.
I tried so hard
to get a two camera shot. I had the black magic. I'm trying to route things through. Totally ridiculous endeavor.
I think people are working on daisy chaining them so you can have multiple cameras working together for a live event or whatever you do. I think it's better than GoPro. But it's not mobile like the way GoPro is. I mean, what I'm using right now. So the bottom large component is the boost, which allows it's a battery basically. So it gives you 10 hours of broadcasting and recording time. It has, and the camera is the tiny part. You can get maybe an hour on its own. It's tiny. You could attach it to something and take it with you, and be mobile.
Can it be hardwired in for power?
Huh?
Can it be hardwired in for power?
Hardwired in for power if you don't want to be mobile. And then the boost also allows you can plug into an Ethernet connection as well, as opposed to being Wi-Fi. And so the camera talks via Bluetooth to your device, and then it uses the internet to broadcast. Yeah, it's a really neat device. You're welcome. Why couldn't I get it to refocus? What's going on there?
You're putting it on the side of your ear. That's not a thing.
How do you make it go again? There, Blair did it. Thank you. I don't even know how to use it anymore. I'm like, why isn't that working? And then you can move the square around and change the production angle. It's pretty great.
I found out the full printed, the 3D printed pizza that I was talking about earlier.
Who printed the 3D printed pizza?
This is from foodfuture2050.com. We talked about it on the show back in... let's see, it was 2015 we talked about it, and they...
Wait, the future was 2 years ago?
Yes, you're correct. Look, they're 3D printing a pizza.
The future of printing, but so it was all soft ingredients, and then they cooked it afterwards?
I don't know.
I want them to print a 3D cooked pizza.
Yeah, it just sort of looks like it's putting down dough.
It is. It's printing down. It's printing the dough
first. It's dispensing dough.
And now
a little bit of crust.
More crust, filling it in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How you 3D print a pizza, everybody?
Yeah. I can't find the actual article. I can only find this video. Because I wish I could tell you exactly what's happening here. But, it was from 2015 and there wasn't a link, so what can you do? We work with what we have.
We do. I wonder if they've improved the pizza printer.
Probably.
Since 2015 to make it a more enjoyable pizza experience. It's all the ingredients. I mean, if your tomato sauce is no good, Come on, we need the food science in there. Get some good tasting stuff. Although the 3D printing of the cheese on it, that would probably be weird.
This is through NASA?
Weird.
Systems and Materials Research Corporation is experimenting with 3D printing of food on a contract from NASA.
On a contract. Oh, because
the pizza printer uses open source technology to print dough, sauce, and cheese into a platform with a heating element underneath. So it cooks as it goes.
Ew. That's why it's terrible.
That's why it's icky.
Ew.
Yeah.
I'm scrolling through my Twitter feed right now. Hello, everybody.
Yeah, so 3D printing pizza. Not sure it's worth the hype.
I don't think it's worth the hype yet. Not yet.
I think it is.
Why?
Because one day you'll be able to have pizza in space.
That's the reason it's funded by NASA. They want to be able to print different kinds
of
food.
They want pizza in space. They want to be able to print food.
I mean, that's a replicator.
That's it. That's what it is.
There you go. Just instead of it getting beamed in via electrons or something like on the show, or it would just materialize. Actually, after 3D printing.
Well, you actually could never see it on the show. It's happening behind the scenes. Maybe it's just a really fast 3D printer.
Ed says he would like to see 3D printing of bacon, and then he'll be impressed.
That's not true.
You know, with BioBot, you could probably 3D print the components of bacon, fat, and muscle cells, and then 3D print little pieces, and then cook them. And it would probably be just fine.
Oh, that's right. I'll be next.
You could probably do that very easily.
Yeah, no.
It is 4:20. This is This Week in Science. We are a weekly science news podcast. Hello, Flibble 42. Nice to see you in the YouTube. Jeremy Faulkner, welcome back to the YouTube chat. Thank you so much for being a part there. Reambiguation, hello. Nice to see you. And Mr. Puffy, I don't know if you're still in there. Hello, Mr. Puffy on the YouTube stream. Over on the Facebook feed, everyone over there, hello. Everyone in the chat room, good to see you there. I love having all these people in all these different places. All over the place. All over the place. All right. So we need to talk about a little bit of science.
Yeah.
We need to talk.
Oh, it's about time. I've been waiting all day to hear some science.
I've been waiting all day. So hold on one second. I got some interesting stories here I can pull up.
And
science.
There is now a meandering of people. Yeah. People are now meandering towards the exits.
Thank you for coming to the Young Innovators Fair. We hope you had a wonderful time.
The events are winding down. Everybody will be dreaming tonight about what inventions they themselves might make.
Yeah.
What would they come up with? What would their booth be at the next Young Innovators Fair?
Science Magazine has an article this week asking the question, is ice sheet collapse in West Antarctica unstoppable? Most climate scenarios paint a bleak future for the West Antarctic ice sheet. So 40 years ago, we discovered that there was trouble in West Antarctica. The ice was thinning. 40 years ago was 40 years ago. And now we have these new models, remote sensing, and precarious West Antarctic ice sheet. But the great thing about this ice sheet is it's an ice sheet that's already in the water. It's not really over
land. Penguin free.
I don't know if it's penguin free, is it?
That's what I'm asking.
I don't know if it is penguin free.
Because it's already in the water, it's melting, doesn't rise sea level.
Exactly.
So that's okay. So it's fine for sea level. It's okay.
That's the side of this news.
Are there penguins there? I want to know if there's penguins.
I'm sure there's
probably
penguins there.
Because the ice is solid. The penguins would probably be on top of it. So this could be a problem for the penguins, but there would be potentially. Anyway, if the low-end ice sheet scenarios are incorrect, or if the required greenhouse gas emissions goals are not achievable, we need to know more about the processes that feedbacks that set the pace of this West Antarctic ice sheet retreat. This demands not only better knowledge of the processes that have been identified by scientists, but also a better understanding of the vast parameter space in which the models used to project the future operate, rather than relying on intuition about which processes are the most important, and on computation-intensive forward searches of these spaces, we should also use statistical inference to identify model biases and attribute uncertainty in their projections to specific approaches. And so these diverse approaches need to be used to correctly understand the implications of different emissions scenarios, or whether, in addition to centuries of committed ice sheet change, we should start planning for a sea level contribution that reaches 20 centimeters per decade by the year 2100. Are we going to end up seeing that, or one-tenth of that amount?
It all depends on us, right?
It all depends on us.
Yep.
That is right.
All right. I found a fun story that we reported on the show.
Oh, you want fun stories?
Yeah.
I went for depressing.
It's about kids and their pets. So when kids have been asked to do stressful things, okay, we found that stress was reduced when they were allowed to have their family dog with them. I wonder how many of these students here today would like to be able to bring their dog into the classroom when they have to do oral reports.
All right, so you can just reach down, pet your dog.
Absolutely. So they found that the dogs helped reduce stress, but having their parents there did not reduce stress.
That makes sense.
So having a dog with you when you might have to do something stressful might actually calm things down quite a bit. I know I would like to have my dog with me. Well, so here's the thing. I wouldn't want to have my dog with me. I'd like to have a well-behaved dog with me. Because that's part of what they found out in this study, too, is that if the dog was wandering around a lot, it actually
made the child more stressed
out. More stressed out, because they were worried about the dog, what the dog was doing. What was the dog getting into? Is my dog embarrassing me? Which is exactly what would happen if I had my dog here right now. But if I had a well-behaved dog here right now, just laying at my feet, I would feel very calm and relaxed and comforted.
Do you know why we're so connected to these dogs of ours?
Codependency.
Oxytocin.
Well, both. Yep. Okay. But really, we've been evolving with our dogs. We've been living with our dogs for a really long time. What was the most recent evidence of humans living with dogs? How far back does it go?
It used to be 10,000 years, but I think they pushed it way farther back, right?
No? I don't think so. Well,
10,000?
Maybe living with dogs, but the most recent evidence from Siberia, bones found in Siberia, suggest that dogs were pulling sleds and being bred by ancient humans 9,000 years ago, so that humans were domesticating dogs and putting them to work for sled driving,
which the Inuits 9,000
years ago.
Which the Inuit are still doing today.
And we have, and the Inuits are doing it, that's for their work. We also have things that are for fun, like the Iditarod sled dog race, in which the dogs actually are having issues now because there's not enough snow on the ground. Sorry, taking it back to the depressing thing. But
And yes, inbreeding of dogs and blah, blah, wah.
But that doesn't mean that they've gotten better at reading us. Because it turns out wild wolves, are actually better at reading human expression than the domesticated dog is.
Really?
Uh-huh. Google it. We did it on the show once.
Yeah, I thought it was the opposite.
No. That would have been like, here's something obvious.
This is what we do. We fact check as we go.
I'm looking.
It was not what you would have expected.
Blair's looking it up.
So in addition, on this study about this evidence for dog breeding 9,000 years ago, the archaeozoologists who worked on this, Melinda Zeter from Smithsonian Institution's National Museum of Natural History in Washington, she said the finding may help explain why people domesticated dogs in the first place to put them to work. And she says it fills in a missing piece of the puzzle of early human-dog relationships and even domestication itself. Where this evidence, these bones, came from was a Russian island called Zhukov Island. And it was inhabited by hunter-gatherers. However, 9,000 years ago, Zhukov wasn't an island. It was actually connected to the mainland. Before the seas rose as ice age glaciers melted, it was a part of the mainland, and so people were going back and forth all the time. And in addition to polar bears, these hunter-gatherers were hunting a lot of animals in the winter, like reindeer that move over the mainland surface. And so they had to go long distances and needed a means for transportation to go after their prey. And so it probably filled a very important need in these hunter-gatherers' lives to domesticate these dogs and use them for sledding. So it's pretty interesting. The researchers have been excavating in this place since 1989, and they've previously found dog bones and the remains of wooden sleds, but it was never clear whether the animals were actually being bred for the purpose of sledding. But now they've got the evidence.
But that doesn't mean they had them as pets. These are work animals.
These were work animals.
So they may have been, there may not have still been what we consider, you know.
But being work animals, they still would have been very well cared for, because you have to have your work animals in decent shape to be able to do the work that you require of them. So they were being fed. They were probably being housed. Well, I mean, sled dogs now aren't necessarily pets.
Not at all.
No.
Not at all. They're kept outdoors.
Yeah.
The Inuits, I got to meet some of the Inuits in Greenland. They are work animals.
Yeah.
They stay outside with the other Canis Borealis. They have a particular kind of husky-looking thing, dog that they use.
Have you found the story yet, Blair?
Well,
I think I found it. And facial recognition. Do we have it? Oh. Human empathy can even extend to dogs. A study by University of Helsinki and Aalto University explored how empathy and other psychological factors affect people's assessment of the facial images of dogs and humans. Human empathy, or the ability to share someone else's feelings or experiences, also affect perceptions of facial expressions of pet dogs. No, this is the other way around.
Yeah, this is about people being
people
able to read
dogs.
Google it separate from ours.
I did. You guys talk amongst yourselves. I'll find it. I promise. Talk amongst yourselves. So people are having impacts on rainfall distribution. According to a study in Science Advances, changes in precipitation patterns could disrupt agricultural productivity. And on the basis of paleoclimatic records, some researchers argue that future rainfall patterns are going to change in response to human-induced global warming. We know this. We're going to move water from where places it is now to other places because of a heat that we're releasing, carbon dioxide that we're releasing into the atmosphere, changes in the atmosphere and the cycles that those influence. Especially alarming is the suggestion that the effects will differ from one season to the next. And during summers, for example, regions that are now wet will become wetter, and regions that are now dry will become drier. During northern winters, rain belts and dry lands will expand northwards. And so climate change predictions need to be taken into account when evaluating future freshwater resources on a global scale. The distribution of freshwater around the globe is going to change.
Yeah, it's one of those things that we were talking about a few weeks ago. About planting trees if you're reforesting an area, by planting trees on the climate model's projection of where that forest's environment will be 40, 50 years from now, and not necessarily on looking backwards on what's thrived there in the past.
Exactly. Geckos. We like geckos, right? They're pretty cute.
I think they're pretty amazing.
We love geckos. So study in the Proclamation of the Royal Society B found that in noisy environments, well, we all know that in noisy environments, you have to be louder. Mammals get louder, birds get louder. Also in cities, city birds are louder at their calls than country birds are. Animals in cities where environment's loud, they just have to be louder. And this is called the Lombard effect, where animals increase the amplitude of their calls in response to the environmental noise. Some researchers tested whether such an effect occurs in reptiles too. Would that happen in reptiles? I don't know. So they tested it.
I can't think of what's the noisiest reptile I should be able to think of. I'm thinking of no
I
loud
know.
Reptiles.
Well, there is a noisy gecko. It's called the noisy toke gecko. Gecko.
Lots of reptiles make sounds.
There are lots.
Well,
maybe
I'm just
not
trying
loud
to say, like,
sounds.
I don't remember hearing.
Have you ever heard a tortoise in mating season?
No.
It's very loud.
I didn't know tortoises were loud.
Can you give us an example of the sound?
No, I'll tell you for the adults tortoise. At the Young Innovators Fair. If we find you out in Phoenixville later, I'll do a rendition then.
Just gonna give us a quick shot right here. What is?
I think Blair doing like a rendition of the tortoise
in heat sound
tortoise
like.
Calls. Hey,
you want it?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Yes.
There you go.
That's the sound.
That is the sound of a tortoise in heat.
That is that. That's what it sounds like.
Wow.
This is good. So anyway, the noisy tokay gecko, they looked at this noisy little gecko to see whether or not the Lombard effect was in place in this animal. Did it get louder with consideration of the noise in its environment? And they didn't really see that. There was no evidence of amplitude alteration. And this is consistent with his absence in other herpetiles. However, they did find that the lizards modulated their calls so that they would be better heard. These geckos increased the length of each call type and varied the percentages of call types that they made with calling in noisy environments, including more loud gecko calls. Gecko, gecko, gecko. More loud gecko calls. And these results suggest that the reptile call flexibility may be higher than thought and suggests that the Lombard effect evolved independently in the bird and mammal lineages. So instead of increasing amplitude, making it louder, they increased how often they call. They have loud calls, and they just started making those loud calls more often.
Interesting.
I'm just going to, if I call more often, the chance that somebody will hear me is going to go up, as opposed to calling once even louder. Seems like a good strategy, but it's not the Lombard effect. It's a different effect that is evolved on its own in this gecko species.
Elephants do something a little different. They use lower end frequencies that can actually send vibrations through the ground.
Yeah.
They can communicate, apparently looking
over miles.
To us it would look silent, as though they weren't talking at all. But they can communicate with each other, making these really low, rumbly sounds.
Rumble, rumble, rumble.
That they can't hear at a distance, perhaps, but can feel through their feet.
What are you looking for now, Blair?
The same. I can only find that dogs understand human facial expressions.
All right.
And I did find one that said that there was no evidence that wolves could. I did not find a comparative study.
According to another Science Magazine article, city trees are important for reducing pollution and improving human health. So in addition to creating oxygen for us to breathe, removing carbon dioxide, trees in cities actually help with pollution control. Good pollution-removing trees include species of elm, magnolia, ash, and holly. Certain species of climbing vines performed better than some trees for these particulate matter capture, for taking little bits of things out of the air. And this is an important consideration when creating green walls and green roofing on city structures. Things that were not effective at particulate matter capture were like a lot of the street species that we currently have in cities. So ginkgo biloba and honeysuckle, which are commonly found in cities on a regular basis.
But they smell nice.
What's on the screen?
Oh, just that.
Nothing.
Am I showing something I shouldn't be?
Oh no. We're being razzed. No. Yeah, so city trees, there are certain species that are better at helping the city have healthier air, and many of them are not trees that we currently use in cities and plant on streets for whatever reasons. But plant more trees, people. Trees are great. Did you know that there is a community of scientists, a network for deaf scientists?
No, but it makes sense.
Yeah. So there's an organization, there's a group that are building a community for deaf scientists who've experienced barriers imposed by hearing loss, and they propose an institutional hub for the deaf and hard of hearing trainees to build their scientific careers from. Pretty neat.
That's great.
Opening doors for more and more people.
Scientists helping scientists.
That's right. Hey, Chad. Can we talk to you and or Gabe? We should talk with you. You started this darn thing, and we haven't talked to you all weekend. What's up with that? This is the end. Wait, let's turn it on.
This is it. Home stretch.
Home stretch. Have a seat. Can you sit down for a second? There we go.
Thank you for letting me sit.
This is probably the first time you've sat down in many hours.
Yeah. Oh, look at that. That's awesome.
Yeah, we have a few little feeds going. We've got our Google Hangout.
Perfect.
Yeah. We can talk to our YouTube audience.
Hello, Internet.
Hello, Internet. Yes. So, Chad, introduce yourself. We talked to your daughter at the beginning of the day. But
great.
Who are you?
I am Chad Collins and co-founder of this event with Gabe Young. So we had the first Young Innovators Fair about 18 months ago.
Right.
But prior to that, we produced two other events. Did Jordan tell you all about the YouTube stuff that we did back in 2012?
No.
No?
She didn't tell us about the YouTube stuff.
Can we have story time?
We can have story time. Please, we like story time.
All right, story time. So back in 2012, I came home one day from the Lego store with a, you know, like in the back of the Lego store, you could fill a cup with all the Lego pieces that you want. You like pay like just for the cup. So I went to the Lego store and I was like, oh my God, like they have this and I have never seen this before and I need to fill it with Lego and bring it home. So I brought it home and shared it with Jordan.
Right.
And that was her introduction to Lego.
Nice.
So we spilled out the cups and we started playing with it. And then the engineer in me was like, how many of the 2x4 bricks can you fit in one of these cups? And he came up with all these ways and then went back to the Lego store and used the process.
Trying to scam the Legos.
Right. Like maximize like every space of the cup.
Did you have to use calculus for that?
Right, it's very complicated. So we got 169 of these 2x4 bricks into a cup.
Okay.
And Jordan said, you know, what can we make YouTube videos together? Because she was getting excited about Lego. She was going onto YouTube, typing in Lego, watching other people do videos.
Watching other people build things, yeah.
And she was inspired by that and asked me if we could do a video together. So we did some videos, and one of them was about how many of these bricks you could put into one of these cups. And that video kind of like got some attention in our little Lego world.
That's awesome.
And it inspired us to keep creating videos. So over the course of 18 months, we put up 500 videos, accumulated 12 million views across all of those videos. And we got to thinking, well, if we have all of this attention on YouTube, how does that translate into a live event? Should we go to a live event and show our audience that you can be in a room just, you know, with people that are just as enthusiastic as you are about this topic?
Yeah.
And we thought that there'd be an event nearby. Because we're from Philadelphia. It's like the fifth biggest market in the country. So a little internet research.
There's no event. There's nothing. Yeah.
Yeah, nothing. So
you gave up. Well, that wasn't much of a story.
Precisely. So look, through the growth of the YouTube channel, we made a lot of friends. The Lego company would invite us to Toy Fair to look at all the sets before they came out because they know we put them on YouTube and they would get some like free media attention out of that.
Right.
So we had friends there. We had a bunch of merchants that would send us stuff to review on our channel for the same reason. So it was cool. We're getting cool stuff. We're getting free stuff in the mail and we're making videos about it.
Right.
So we reached out to everyone and said, hey, if we had a show, if we had a Brickfest, would you participate? And it was like yeses across the board. So that's what motivated us to come to the Philly Expo Center.
Okay.
And convince them to lease a room to someone that's never produced an event before.
That's what I was going to ask. I was going to say, have you ever produced anything before?
Yeah, no.
No. Okay.
And,
big learning experience then.
Right. I've implemented stuff, but I've never produced a large-scale event.
Yeah.
So in 2014, we had our first ever Philly Brickfest. And at that first event, we had about 24,000 people show up.
Wow.
And it was right here, Hall A of the Greater Philadelphia Expo Center. So,
and so right now for the Young Innovators Fair, we've got four rooms that we're filling.
Yeah, this is bigger.
This is bigger. So you've got one of these rooms for that original event.
Oh. Right.
With 24,000 people.
Correct. Yeah, I was like, yeah.
Added.
There was maybe a fire code item or two.
Yeah.
But we knew that there was enthusiasm around that topic, right?
Absolutely.
And Lego, as you know, is an educational tool. And we thought, well, if there's this much enthusiasm in the Philadelphia area, then that means there's got to be enthusiasm in other parts of the country. So that inspired us to go and find other facilities to produce BrickFest Live, which right. is now the, you know, it's a really large touring convention.
Yeah,
we're doing 20 weekends this year nationwide, right? So
congratulations on creating something that's
really
successful.
Awesome.
That's
wonderful. Yeah, it's been a lot of fun. And Jordan obviously was a catalyst for that. So she,
great.
Without her saying, hey, let's create a YouTube video on Lego, right?
I have to say, she's a spitfire.
Yeah.
She is something.
Right. She is. Yeah, she loves it. So you see, like, she'll get on stage and stuff. She'll talk with you here.
Oh, she had no qualms. She just came up here and she started talking.
Yep.
I was like, are you our new host? Okay, great. I'm leaving.
And like the YouTube stuff helped with that because, you know, we were in front of the camera all the time. And
yeah,
it was fun. So from that event, the next event we produced, Gabe and I produced Young Innovators Fair back in 2016.
Yes.
And as you can see with Young Innovators Fair, we have all these different disciplines in science and tech. And one of the worlds is Hacker's Hideout, which is, you know, we at the first Young Innovators Fair, we had a lot of Minecraft stuff there. And we saw so much attention on Minecraft. And then we learned that there was a whole educational aspect of Minecraft.
There totally is.
In fact, there's an education edition that they use as a teaching aid in classrooms.
Yep.
And that's come up in all these interviews we've been doing with these young innovators today, over and over again. How did you get started? Well, I really liked Minecraft. Legos and Minecraft both came up a tremendous amount.
Yeah, yep. So there's a lot to be said for that. So these three events that we produced, BrickFest Live, Mindfair.
We spoke with a gentleman this morning who works with you on Mindfair.
So it was probably Steve Isaacs.
Yes.
Yes, and now Young Innovators Fair. This is the one where it gives us as a producer to say, where's the attention? What's going to be the next big thing? Because
right.
it's in this room, and people are interested in it, and it's up to say, well, how, when we come back next time, we know what to provide our audience with, because we know from the feedback that they've given us, like, what works, what inspires them, what lights that spark.
This is your sandbox.
This is our sandbox.
If it was up to Blair, it would be all smoke machines.
Right.
Yeah, smoke machines and animals. That's all this would be.
Right. It would be like buckets of water and dry ice.
Yeah.
All over the place.
Absolutely.
No, Blair would be here with animals.
Yeah.
She'd be like, can we put the zoo in this building?
More animals. We can get more animals.
What was your favorite part? I mean, you're wandering around as a producer, making mm-hmm. sure nothing goes wrong, and you're on top of putting out fires. Not actually, but metaphorical
fire. That would be possible.
For the record, I believe there were no actual fires.
Yeah.
There was flash paper.
There was flash paper. That's different. Yeah. But what was your favorite thing here this year that you saw?
My favorite exhibit this year. Did you guys eat bugs?
Yes.
We did, and we
they
made Blair eat the bugs. She didn't want
they
to.
Were good.
The bugs were cool. There was a giant maker space.
Yes.
Off in the other room there. Okay. Let's see. You know, Bose has a DIY speaker.
I saw that.
Sorry, that's what happens.
That's your business stuff right there. That's your business. Yeah, Bose has that speaker. That's amazing.
Bose has that speaker, and they do this little thing where they have a magnet, and then they have the copper coil, and they send electricity to it, and then that's what bounces and causes the vibrations that then create sound waves, right? So teaching all of that to kids was super cool. And then I also learned about mussels and how mussels are nature's natural water purifier. So
mussels, not like Muscles.
Through the estuary.
Muscles.
The actual.
Muscles.
The filter feeder.
Bivalves.
Yes.
Delicious. Bivalves. Yes.
So, right. So there's an exhibit where they have one tank that is dirty, right? And another tank that's less dirty because it has mussels in it that are cleaning out the water. So I learned all about that. I learned how mussels breed. Do you know how mussels breed?
Yeah, they're broadcast spawners.
Yes. They need a host. So they shoot up and then the fish swims through and it connects to the fish's gills. And then a fish drops the eggs somewhere else and then the larva digs a hole into the sand and then more mussels. Yeah.
And then more mussels.
I never knew that I would know so much about mussels,
but
you only know because you come to an event like this, right?
And you're exposed to things that maybe you didn't even know you would be interested in before. I think that's the big thing. Like, you've got so many different disciplines, different areas of science and technology, engineering and math, and arts. You've got all of it here. You've got so many different areas that there's something for everybody.
Absolutely.
And you can go, like, tinker on little things, find something, be like, oh, I'm not into that, but oh, that I really love. And find what really kids and adults can really find something that inspires them.
And I also
them.
Found the kids very inspiring. The kids who are putting on and presenting are the best representatives of getting other kids excited.
Kids are going to listen to other kids.
They were passionate about it, and they were, you know, starting their own clubs and getting other kids involved in. So
yeah,
they were really the amazing.
I was very inspired by GLIST. The little girls coding club. It's a middle school coding club. That's great.
I'll tell you, the magical things that happen at events like this is a family's going to come to the event, and they may or may not know what their young innovator is interested in.
Right.
And they're going to see what they're interested in at this event by exploring together. They're going to participate with them side by side. So now the kid is getting that parent attention, that interaction that they maybe won't get as much at home, but there's nowhere else to go when you're in this room.
Right.
And then the parent is going to be able to deliver more of what they're interested in because of what they learned about their child only because they came.
Yeah, they won't come home talking about something that their parents don't understand. Their parents will at least understand what booth they were talking about and go away with a card that then they can find out more. Yeah,
in fact,
and hopefully it's my child is not too excited by hissing cockroaches. I want to encourage them.
What's wrong with hissing cockroaches?
Nothing. But if they want to raise them at home, let's pick something else.
They make excellent pets, actually.
Hissing cockroaches are fantastic.
Yeah.
Yes.
There's some giant cockroaches
over
there.
Those are those Madagascar hissing cockroaches that we're talking about. The charter school that had that the insects. They brought them over and told us all about them, and we got to touch a millipede and a cockroach and eat some other bugs.
Well, I'll tell you what, I mean, you hit on a good point about how, you know, the parent is going to understand what they were talking about because they were at the booth. And we talk about that happening, but even from yesterday to today, there's already a story about that actually happening, where there was a family that was at the Rowan College booth, and we got an email this morning from the mother that talked about their experience at that booth and how they're already doing things that they learned because they were
nice.
There.
Oh, that's great.
Like
that's
instant,
perfect.
Like the loop, right? We closed the loop right there.
Already, and they're already going off and innovating.
Yeah, they're already headed down a path. Yeah.
I love it.
That's why this event exists.
It's a special event. It's a great event, and I'm so glad that you're producing it.
We're so happy you're here.
I want to say thank you for inviting us to be here. We've had such a good time talking with people today and yesterday about all of the things in this area that people are working on, the ideas they have to inspire the up-and-coming generation of children, new technologies that are being developed to help third-world countries. I mean, there's so much happening. It's awesome.
It's
great. So thank you for letting us be a part of it.
Yeah,
our pleasure.
Really, really appreciate
so much fun.
Our pleasure.
Great.
Home stretch.
And next year, are you doing it again?
Stay tuned. Yes.
Stay tuned. Or maybe it's like an every 2 years kind of thing.
There will be Young Innovator Fairs
next year. Fairs.
Plurals.
Oh. Fairs.
There will be fairs.
I heard an S on the end of that.
Yeah. Well, good, because there's definitely a demand for it. That's that much we've seen today.
Yeah. Cool.
Thank you so much. I'm glad all we got a chance to talk with you.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. Bye. Bye. Thank you. Home stretch. Close it out.
Absolutely.
We are almost at the 5 o'clock.
Yes.
Oh, man.
Yeah, this is a great event, and I'm going to leave here inspired. I mean, I think, Blair, you made the comment also. It just makes you a little bit more hopeful about the future of humanity in this world we exist in. There are a lot of creative ideas.
I saw a giant expo center full of change makers. And that's what it takes, right? They're changing things in one way or another. They're changing how we do things. They're changing how we get things. They're changing how we look at things.
Yeah.
These are the change makers, and they're going to bring us through the revolution that's necessary to keep going on a path of improvement and keep this planet healthy and all of those sorts of things. And this is really fostering the critical thinking skills that we need in today and in the future to get us there.
Yeah, and also coming from a world of being an adult surrounded by old, stuck in their ways people, getting to see the flip side of that, which is young, innovative people, is really refreshing. It's a nice change.
Absolutely. Well, and I work every day with kids of varying ages, right? But in one specific area, and it's so great to have a space where there was a couple places where little Blair would have gone. There's a couple places where, you know, my older brother, who didn't like anything that I liked on principle, would have gone here.
Right.
I can see how a family where maybe one child was the spark to come here as a family, everyone would find something here.
Absolutely.
And everyone would leave here inspired.
Yeah. Like I said, there's just so many different areas covered here. There's something for everybody.
Mm-hmm. And how great that we got to talk about coding and neurons and water systems.
Ecosystems.
Water purification.
Yeah.
Robots. We talked about all of it.
We talked about technology use in education. We talked about new perspectives on education. Mm-hmm. We talked about we talked about art and science being put together for educational purposes. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's so many wonderful conversations were had. Mm-hmm. Goodbye. Have a wonderful, wonderful rest of your weekend. Enjoy your Sunday. We'll have to check out the Star Wars Geek Girl podcast.
Yes.
We did talk about Star Wars for a little bit.
It's true.
We talked about Ghostbusters.
Yep.
Star Wars. Mm-hmm. We talked about slime. We talked about insects.
Surprisingly, lack of Star Trek at this.
I know. You'll notice I left my Star Trek hoodie at the hotel today.
That's too bad.
Because I saw all the Star Wars colors out.
You could have showed up and represented.
I don't want to cause any trouble.
What color shirt do you wear again? Is it are you a red shirt? Are you a gold shirt?
It's supposed to be a blue shirt.
Science officer.
Bye, Brayden. Have a wonderful rest of your weekend. Brayden is a 7-year-old innovator who has come up with a Lego-inspired way to get kids into recycling, and we talked with him. He was a great kid to talk to. He's got lots of great ideas. I hope people are leaving here right now filled with ideas. I hope you had a good time. Thank you for visiting the Young Innovators Fair. Have a wonderful Sunday evening. Your crowns are fabulous.
Yes. The royalty is heading out.
Royalty.
Royalty is making ingress.
Do a special royalty wave. Have a wonderful, wonderful evening. Everyone, thank you so much for coming out to the Young Innovators Fair. Thank you to the innovators who have come to the Innovators Fair to share their innovations. Thanks for waving at us. Thanks for stopping and talking. Thank you, security, for keeping us secure.
Yes.
Yes. Yes, you should take a bow. That's some good work. Have a good evening. It is 5 o'clock p.m. It's the end of the Young Innovators Fair. We are This Week in Science, and we are going to say adieu. Philadelphia. Adieu. This is our last evening here. So thank you very much, those of you online who have been checking in throughout the weekend. We do appreciate your attention. We hope you found something yourselves that was interesting. And we will be back Wednesday evening.
Oh, yeah.
Live online.
We sure will.
8 p.m. Yeah. Pacific time, 11 p.m. Would you like a patch or a pin or a sticker? We've got things up here. Sorry about the climbing. Don't injure yourself. But this is going to be it for us. It's adults and kids. All ages.
All ages.
It's an all ages program. And we're adults, so it's probably...
Mostly adulties.
We have high school listeners, college listeners.
People of all ages, but we're not like doing basic science like you would see maybe on a Bill Nye or Beakman's World kind of a show.
We do science. We're a science news podcast.
So it's whatever happened this week that's just broken in science.
Online.
Yep. We're on the YouTubes.
Yep. You can find us online. Absolutely. Thank you. Okay.
All right.
I'm going to shut down this feed.
Say goodnight, buddy.
That's it, folks.
That's right. This has, you know what? There's a lot in our head. What are we supposed to say at the very end?
It's all in our
and
head.
And if you've learned anything from this weekend's event, remember,
it's all in your head.
I got some music here to go out on. Let's go out on some music.
This week in science. This week in science. This week in science, it's the end of the world. So I'm setting up shop, got my banner unfurled. It says the scientist is in, I'm gonna sell my advice. Show them how to stop the robots with a simple device. I'll reverse global warming with a wave of my hand. And all it'll cost you is a couple of grand. This week's science is coming your way. So everybody listen to what I say. I use the scientific method for all that it's worth. And I'll broadcast my opinion all over the earth. Cause it's this week in science. This week in science. This week in science. 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 This week in science. This week in science. This week in science. 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 I've got one disclaimer and it shouldn't be news. That what I say may not represent your views. But I've done the calculations and I've got a plan. If you listen to the science, you may just get understand. That we're not trying to threaten your philosophy. We're just trying to save the world from jeopardy. And this week in science is coming your way. So everybody listen to everything we say. And if you use our method instead of rolling a die, we may rid the world of toxoplasma. Gandhi, aye. Cause it's this week in science. This week in science. This week in science. 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 This week in science. This week in science. This week in science. 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 I've got a laundry list of items I want to address. From stopping global hunger to dredging Loch Ness. I'm trying to promote more rational thought. And I'll try to answer any question you got. So how can I ever see the changes I seek when I can only set up shop 1 hour a week? This week in science is coming your way. You better just listen to what we say. And if you've learned anything from the words that we've said, then please just remember it's all in your head. This week in science, this week in science, this week in science, 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 this week in science, this week in science, this week in science, 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 this week in 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 science. We'll be right back.
more than intuition. A live breeze that shows the way to go. New conclusion. The methods are hypothesis, and patience are the only things I need. Put on a pair of goggles and go looking for the things I couldn't see. The answers lie somewhere within this scattered plot. First assumptions were correct, disprove the rest. It's hot. The methods of hypothesis and patience are the only things I need. Put on a pair of goggles and go looking for the things I couldn't see. The methods of hypothesis and patience are the only things I need. Put on a pair of goggles and go looking for the things I could not see. I couldn't see.
feel so dirty when they start talking cute. I wanna tell her that I love her, but the point is probably moot. Cause she's watching him with those eyes, and she's loving him with that body, I just know it. And he's holding her in his arms late, late at night. You know I wish that I had Jesse's girl. I wish that I had Jesse's girl. I can never find a woman like that, like Jesse's girl. I wish that I had Jesse's girl. I can't find a woman. I can't find a woman like that. When I'm looking in the mirror all the time, wondering what she don't see in me. I've been funny, I'm cool with the lines. Ain't that the way I'm supposed to be? Tell me, why can't I find a woman like that? You know I wish that I had Jesse's girl. I wish that I had Jesse's girl. I want Jesse's girl. Why can't I find a woman like Jesse's girl? I wish that I had Jesse's girl. I want Jesse's girl. Come wonder where you are tonight. No answer on the telephone. And the night goes by so very slow. Oh, I hope that it won't end alone. Your lips and hold you tight. Oh, you don't know how long I have waited, and I was gonna tell you tonight. But the secret is still my own, and my love for you is still unknown. Alone. Thank you.
to